Good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting of Session 6 of the Criminal Justice Committee. Apologies have been received this morning from Katie Clark. And the first agenda item is to agree whether to take Item 6 in private, which is consideration of today's evidence. Are we all agreed? Yep. Thank you. Our next agenda item is consideration of two affirmative instruments. Firstly, the draft conference of the parties to the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, Immunities and Privileges, Scotland Order 2021, and the draft European Union and European Atomic Energy Community, Immunities and Privileges, Scotland Order 2021. And I welcome to the meeting Ash Denham, Minister for Community Safety, Susan Black, Senior Policy Officer, Civil Law and Legal System Division, and Joanne Tinto, Solicitor, Constitutional and Civil Law Division of the Scottish Government Legal Directorate. And I refer members to paper number one, and I invite the Minister to speak to the draft conference of the parties to the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, Immunities and Privileges Scotland Order 2021.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the committee. So the draft conference of the parties to the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, Immunities and Privileges Scotland Order 2021 confers various legal immunities and privileges upon the conference of the parties to the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change and specified participants. COP26 is considered to be the most significant climate change event since the 2015 Paris Agreement. It's the biggest summit the UK has ever hosted, and welcoming this climate change conference to Scotland is a huge honour. To enable COP26 to fulfil its purpose and to take place successfully, it's been agreed that certain privileges and immunities require to be granted to certain attendees. So a host country agreement negotiated between the UK government and the UNFCCC Secretariat regulates the privileges and immunities that are to be afforded to certain COP26 attendees. For example, certain tax exemptions, immunity from legal process. The agreement obliges the UK to abide by the terms of the protocol on privileges and immunities. And the order that is before the committee today gives effect to those agreed obligations insofar as they relate to devolved matters in Scotland. Equivalent provisions in respect of host country agreement obligations for reserved matters and devolved matters in the rest of the UK is being made by order in council at Westminster. However, to the extent that privileges and immunities relate to devolved matters, this obviously rightly falls to the Scottish Parliament. So subject to parliamentary consideration in this Parliament and at Westminster, both orders in council will then be signed. So in order to assist the committee, I'll just say a little bit, if that's okay, Convener, about the nature of the privileges and immunities involved. So the order provides that the representatives of parties to the UNFCCC, the Kyoto Protocol and the Paris Agreement, the representatives of observer states and officials of the specialised agencies of the UN will have immunity from suit and legal process. These immunities cover things done or omitted to be done only while exercising their official functions in connection with the Glasgow Conference and during their journeys to and from the conference premises. It also provides for the inviolability of any private residence used by representatives during COP26, exemptions and privileges in respect of personal baggage, and exemption or relief from all devolved local taxes. Importantly, the order permits that immunity can be expressly waived by any appropriate party or state. The order also provides limited immunity from suit and legal process for representatives of the Executive Board of the Clean Development Mechanism. This immunity is only conferred whilst the Executive Board is exercising their official functions as part of the conference. And this immunity can also be waived by the Secretary General of the UN. It's customary for such a sovereign state to grant such privileges and immunities to diplomatic missions and international organisations to enable them to function. The host country agreement agreed between the UK and the UN in respect of COP26 is broadly in line with global practice and includes provisions to ensure that immunities and privileges do not impede the proper administration of justice. It's important to emphasise that immunity does not provide carte blanche for officials to ignore the laws and regulations of the host country. The privileges and immunities conferred by this draft order are granted primarily on the basis of strict functional need, and it's been agreed by the UK and the UN that they are no greater in extent than those required to enable the COP26 and the specified individuals connected with the COP to function effectively. Immunities and privileges are limited in that they only apply to official functions undertaken in connection with the Glasgow Conference and can be waived, and they do not give an individual freedom to commit criminal activity. The immunity is similar but more limited to that which has been for generations conferred upon diplomats working in foreign jurisdictions. As with diplomatic immunity, all individuals benefiting from privileges and immunities in Scotland are expected to respect Scots law, both criminal and civil. To conclude, the draft order implements the agreement the UK has reached with UNFCCC in line with global practice. It enables COP to hold its 26th conference in Glasgow and to conduct associated activities in the UK while ensuring and upholding protections for the effective administration of justice. As a good global citizen, it's the responsibility of the Scottish Government to bring it forward to the Parliament. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Minister. That's very helpful. Can I open it up to members if you have any questions? No? Okay, thank you very much. I'll now invite the Minister to speak to the draft European Union and European Atomic Energy Community Immunities and Privileges Scotland Order 2021.
The purpose of the European Union and European Atomic Energy Community Immunities and Privileges Scotland Order 2021 confers immunities and privileges insofar as they are within devolved competence upon the delegation of the European Union and the European Atomic Energy Agency, or Euratom, and their staff members, diplomatic agents and their family members. These privileges and immunities are conferred in accordance with the UK-EU Establishment Agreement. The order before the committee today will give effect to the devolved aspects of that agreement. Equivalent provision in respect of reserved matters and the devolved matters in the rest of the UK has already been conferred by legislation at Westminster, and that was in July 2021. However, to the extent that the privileges and immunities relate to devolved matters, this again falls to the Scottish Parliament. And before I go into the draft order in further detail, it might be helpful to set out the background. So following the UK's departure from the EU established a delegation to the UK, and that delegation replaced the European Commission representation. The EU delegation is responsible for representing the interests of the EU in the UK and for coordinating among the 27 EU member states. And EU delegations exist in over 140 countries outside the EU around the world. And the EU negotiates establishment agreements with each of those countries in which it has delegations in order to regulate the EU's status, privileges and immunities. Legislation is required to implement those agreed obligations from the UK-EU establishment agreement into domestic UK law. Two separate orders are required, a Scottish order and a parallel UK order. The UK order came into force on the 22nd of July this year. And whilst there are contingency measures currently in place by virtue of the EU Withdrawal Act of 2018, without a Scottish order being made, there remains disparity between Scotland and the rest of the UK in giving effect to the establishment agreement. So the details of the order are that the order treats the EU delegation, including Euratom, in broadly similar terms to those agreed with other non-EU governments globally. Important provisions are included to ensure that the immunities and privileges conferred do not impede the proper administration of justice. The order provides the EU delegation with criminal, civil and administrative immunity when operating within their official activities. The premises and archives of the delegation, insofar as they're in Scotland, are also to be inviolable, while the property and assets of the delegation in Scotland are to be immune from search, confiscation or other interference. EU staff members who've been notified to the Foreign Office as diplomatic agents will have their criminal, civil and administrative immunity, including the inviolability of their residence. Diplomatic agents and their family members are also not obliged to give evidence as witnesses, and their personal baggage is exempt from inspection unless there are serious grounds that can be shown for doing so. The draft order will also confer criminal, civil and administrative immunity in respect of staff members, including immunity from personal arrest and detention, but again only in respect of the exercise of their functions within the scope of their official activities. Staff members also receive inviolability of their official papers and correspondence. The draft order provides for certain fiscal exemptions for the delegation, its staff and their family members, and these include exemptions from direct taxes on the assets, property, income and operations of the delegation. The diplomatic agents, staff members and their family are also afforded various exemptions in respect of their furniture and personal effects, as well as relief from paying council tax. They are, however, not entitled to any benefits paid in respect of devolved matters. Importantly, the order permits that immunity can be expressly waived in certain circumstances for both diplomatic agents and staff members and their family members. Immunity and inviolability is not conferred in respect of any alleged road traffic accidents and road traffic incidents. To conclude, the draft order implements the establishment agreement that the UK has reached with the EU regarding its delegation in London, and in line with global practice, and it enables the delegation to conduct its activities in the UK whilst ensuring and upholding protections for the effective administration of justice. The European Union delegation plays an important role in the UK-EU relationship, supporting a partnership based on friendly cooperation, and so I commend it to the committee. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Minister. Again, I invite any questions from members. Okay, thank you very much. In that case, so I beg your pardon.
It wasn't really a question. It was just to see, you explained that very thoroughly, so I didn't really have any questions, but I thought it was just worth noting that you specifically mentioned that it wouldn't be immunity from road traffic incidents, because that's the one that sprung to mind, thinking about the immunity issue around a road traffic. So I don't have a question, but I just wanted to note that, and thank you for your thoroughness.
I thank Pauline McNeill for noting that. That was a change, and that is a specific carve-out that has been agreed for this instrument.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. So in that case, we'll move straight on to item number three, which is the formal business in relation to the instrument. So our next agenda item is consideration of motions for approval for the two affirmative instruments. I invite the Minister to move that motion, number 926, that the Criminal Justice Committee recommends that the Conference of the Parties to the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, Immunities and Privileges, Scotland Order 2021, be approved.
Formally moved, Convener.
Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. And I now invite the Minister to move the motion number 00931, that the Criminal Justice Committee recommends that the European Union and European Atomic Energy Community Immunities and Privileges Scotland Order 2021 be approved.
Formally moved.
Thank you very much. Do any other members have any other comments? Okay, are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. So I invite the committee to agree to delegate to me the publication of a short factual report on our deliberations on both the affirmative SSIs that we have considered today. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much. And that completes consideration of the two affirmative instruments, and I thank the Minister and her officials for attending. Thank you.
Thanks.
So our next agenda item is a roundtable discussion about prisons and prison policy, and I refer members to papers numbers 3 and 4. We will take evidence today from a round table of witnesses who will be joining us virtually. I'm sorry you cannot join us in person, but this is due to the current rules around social distancing. And I welcome our panel of witnesses this morning. We have Mr. Alan Staff, Chief Executive of Apex Scotland, Mr. Bruce Adamson, Children and Young People's Commissioner, Wendy Sinclair Gibbon, Her Majesty's Chief Inspector of Prisons for Scotland, Dr. Katrina Morrison, Committee Secretary of Howard League Scotland, John Watt, the Chair of the Parole Board for Scotland, Mr. Philip Fairley, Assistant General Secretary of the Prison Officers Association in Scotland, Professor Fergus McNeill, Professor of Criminology and Social Work at the University of Glasgow Scottish Centre for Crime and Research and Justice Research, and Ms. Teresa Medhurst, Interim Chief Executive, and Alistair Purdy, Interim Director of Operations at the Scottish Prison Service. And we very much appreciate you taking the time to join us this morning. I thank those witnesses who have provided a written submission, and these are now available online. So I intend to allow around an hour and 15 minutes for questions and discussion. So please can I ask members to indicate which witness you are directing your remarks to. We can then open the floor to other witnesses for comments. If other witnesses wish to respond, please can I ask you to indicate that by typing an R in the chat function on BlueJeans and I will bring you in. And if time permits, if you are merely agreeing with what the witness is saying, there's no need for you to intervene. Other comments you make in the chat function won't be visible to committee members or recorded anywhere. So if you want to make a comment, please do so by requesting to speak. So we'll now move directly to questions. And please, can I ask members and our invited guests to keep your questions and comments as succinct as possible. I'm very keen to encourage a free-flowing discussion. So I'd like to start off by inviting Ms. Pauline McNeill to ask some questions, and then I'll bring in Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to everyone. So my question is around the conditions that prisoners on remand and other prisoners are held in our prison estate. I'm sure I don't need to say, but just for the record, we have some of the highest numbers of prisoners on remand in Europe, an average of 18 months. Notwithstanding we've had the pandemic, these figures are alarming. So what I'm interested in for there's quite a few members of the panel I was interested to get an answer from. I thought perhaps Wendy Sinclair, Dr. Katrina Morrison from the Howard League, Phil Fairley and Teresa Mater might like to answer this question, which is it time to consider that there should be some specific rights, particularly for remand prisoners and the prison population generally, around being out of their cell a certain time in the day? And indeed, I'm certainly keen that prisoners, all prisoners, should have a right to have some fresh air. And I realise there's capacity issues and estate issues. And I'd also want to put on record my admiration for work done by prison officers and those involved in running our prison estate. The papers really dug deep into the intricacies of our rising, ageing population and all the things. So I'm really conscious of that. But I am interested in moving forward in Scotland, looking to the future, where ideally we'd like to be. So that's my question. Is it time for specific enforceable rights or even a charter of rights for prisoners to be allowed out of their cells once a day or a prescribed amount of time and to get fresh air? Thank you very much. Perhaps maybe it's easy if I just see, we start with Wendy Sinclair, the prison inspector.
Good morning. Yes, I'd be delighted to answer that actually. The remand prisoner is something that has exercised me for a long time. I think there are some fundamental principles that need to be explored. One is that there are human rights that are designed for all prisoners, regardless of whether they're on remand or convicted. And therefore, the Charter of Rights already exists. And because we signed up to OPCAT, we actually should be following those guidelines. The second part of that is there is a real need to review the prison rules, which inhibit some of the things that would make a difference for remand prisoners. And the third part for me is we need to have a recognition that for somebody to be remanded in custody, they've already tangled with the police and entered the criminal justice system. And we therefore need to tackle the criminogenic reasons behind that, even if that is poverty, debt, etc. So for me, I see no reason for remand prisoners to not be afforded the existing privileges, and furthermore, for remand prisoners to be able to access everything except for those activities that relate specifically to convicted offenders.
Thank you very much. Dr. Katrina Morrison from the Howard League. It's just the same question.
Yes, thank you. Yes, thank you very much. Thank you for the question. Yes, we strongly believe that it's not good enough, first of all, that we've got so many people on remand, and second of all, that the regime that they have is so reduced and restricted, especially in light of the fact that, you know, 57% of them go on to not even receive a custodial sentence when they are sentenced. That's either because they're found not guilty or they receive a community sentence. So it's really so the time that they have in custody absolutely has to be spent well, because, you know, the stigma that exists for them and for potentially their families outside is the same as a sentenced prisoner. So yeah, we would absolutely support any proposals to give them the same opportunities for work and access to programmes, etc., that the rest of the population have.
Thank you very much. Phil Fairley from the Prison Officers Association.
Yeah, good morning, and thanks for the question, Pauline. I think you touched on it yourself. The issue for us is capacity and ability to have resource and the time to give to the untried population. We'll probably get into some of the reasons as to why capacity is tied up the way it is in the prison system when we get talking about overcrowding, which I'm sure will come up. But part of that overcrowding is the numbers of untried that we've got inside our system. There are simply too many people sitting in untried conditions inside our prisons, and the ability to do all that we would want to do with them simply does not exist. There's no pride or satisfaction for prison staff who, by and large, are doing no more than warehousing some of that population behind doors for long periods of time. There's no satisfaction or pride in any of that. There's nothing meaningful being delivered by that other than keeping somebody out of the community. But if we're serious about tackling that, serious about doing something about it, it is a capacity and a resource issue. It's the elephant in the room often in some of these discussions that we have around prisons, but if we're genuinely serious about tackling it, then it'll require a rethink in terms of what we mean by resourcing that.
Thank you very much. Can I just lastly just ask Teresa Mayhurst if she would answer the same question? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good morning, convener. Good morning, committee members and colleagues. And thank you for the question, Ms. McNeill. I would just like to say that I do would agree with a number of the points that have already been made. The prison rules, I think, are one area where there is a require to refresh and better reflect a more modern prison system, if you like. So that is something that needs to be taken forward. The time out of cell and fresh air is enshrined in prison rules. That was limited during the early part of the pandemic, but has been consistently in place since then for everyone, not just those on remand. And the final thing I would say around service provision is that there is as was pointed out earlier, the same disconnect for people coming into custody on remand and for the period of time that they're in remand between them and their families and communities as there are for people on short-term sentences. And whilst there are services and supports available in prisons for those on remand, that provision is variable. We need a degree more consistency in that. And in order to do that, as Bill rightly points out, there are resource and capacity issues. But I think through a real focus on improving our digital capacity and capability, there is a lot more that we could do as a service in ensuring that there is consistent provision, regardless of whether or not someone is on remand or serving a sentencing.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. I think before we move on, I think Mr. Adamson, you were quite keen to come in on that and say a few words.
Yes, I was, Convener, and thank you so much for the questions, McNeil. I think it's really important that we consider that there are a number of children on remand in the adult system, and I strongly associate with what the Office of Her Majesty's Inspector for Prisons in Scotland has been saying around the fact that there's a human rights framework already in place for this, and particularly in relation to children who are entitled to additional rights through the Convention on the Rights of the Child. And it's really concerning that our track record on this in Scotland in terms of remanding children in young offenders institutes is really concerning, and much more so than the adult population. And so while in the adult population it's around 26%, I believe, the average for children and young people is actually around 80-85%. It fluctuates, but that much, much higher percentage of children who are in YOIs are there on remand, and so the vast majority are there. And that's a really significant concern because they spend a lot longer time in cells than those that have been sentenced, and they experience the least amount of support and activities. So it's very important that we address this, but primarily by getting those children out of detention. And it's really important that we look at the bail and remand provisions and early release provisions, particularly in relation to the COVID regulations, because no child under 18 should be remanded or sentenced, and there should be a presumption of alternatives to custody. And I'm really concerned that since the onset of the pandemic, there's not been a proper assessment of whether the children that are in Parliament pose any risks and why they can't be managed in the community. And they should have been included within the early release scheme, but weren't included within that. And that's contrary to all of the human rights advice from the UN Committee on the Rights of the Child, but also the Council of Europe statement on principles in relation to the pandemic and emergency measures. And so children are being disproportionately affected by this. And remember, children's everyone up to 18. So this is something we need to take urgent action on in getting all children out of young offenders institutions, particularly in the context of COVID, and into more appropriate ways of receiving support.
Can I just clarify the figure that was given? Bruce, did you say that was 80-85%? Is that the figure you gave?
Yeah, so currently it's around 88%, but the figures that we have from the daily population data, it's been fluctuating. Firstly, it's gone up. It was sitting around 2/3, but since COVID, it's actually gone up and now fluctuating between 76% right up to 94% actually in April this year. I mean, we are talking about relatively low numbers, kind of around 20 or so, kind of fluctuates about 120 individuals covered throughout the year, but about 20 at any given time. So I appreciate that plays into the statistics. But the underlying point being the majority of children who we put into the adult prison system, that's everyone up to 18, are there on remand, and that's hugely concerning. So I think this is a really urgent point that we need to focus on. I think we need to talk about why children are in the first place. They shouldn't be, but remand children particularly.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And before we move on, I think Alan Staff, Mr. Staff, you would like to come in on this as well.
Yes, thank you. I'd like to just amplify a little bit something that Teresa mentioned. A person in any kind of custodial sentence suffers significant disruption to their life, particularly around areas of employment continuity, relationships, accommodation and so forth. There is no distinction between a person who is on remand and a person who has a sentence, except that there are a number of services available for assisting people when they come out of a sentence. Those services generally don't cater for people coming out of a remand situation, but the problems that they face are identical in many ways. People coming out of a remand situation may be more disadvantaged. So I would just highlight this is a significant problem and one that we shouldn't take our eyes off. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Staff. I think just to keep the flow of questioning, if I may, I'll bring in Mr. Findlay and then I'll bring in Ms. Mackay after that.
Thank you. It's a question for Bruce Adamson, who's already touched on the issue of young people entering prison and being remanded and that initial cycle of violence becoming a thing that defines them and sets off the whole chain of continual offending. When we visited the Lord President a couple of weeks ago, he told us that we will look back and regard the way we treated young people as barbaric. That was the word he used. And this morning brings news reports that the Scottish Sentencing Council is calling for the courts to make rehabilitation rather than punishment a primary consideration. So the judiciary seem to be on the same page. Have we turned a corner, or is this just more of the same from a Scottish Government quango?
I really welcome the announcement today from the Sentencing Council. I think the starting point needs to always be that we see children as children in the first instance, and we take a rights-based approach to their work. I think we have been making progress in Scotland, but not at the level of urgency that is required by the rights of children and young people. And again, I agree with the Chief Inspector in terms of the way that she set out the challenges that we need to face. But the primary thing is that children under 18 should not be deprived of their liberty in prisons or young offenders institutions. We need to focus on ensuring that children receive the support through really good quality, intensive support, possibly in a secure setting, but not through a prison system. And this urgently needs to change. Sentencing is part of that. And so it's really useful that we've got some progress in relation to the promise, which has got and the Care and Justice Bill and the incorporation of the Convention on the Rights of the Child. But these things need to move much, much quicker, because locking children in prisons as punishment is contrary to international law and standards. And we need to make sure that we focus on children being all the way up to 18. And the UN Committee on the Rights of the Child, particularly in their General Comment 24, focuses on this being child justice. So we need to really rethink the way in which we focus on how we support children under 18 who are in conflict with the law. And so the Scottish Sentencing Council, the new guidance, are a very welcome step. They're based on really strong research, which looks at the brain development and taking into account trauma and poverty, addiction, mental health and adversity, and setting that within a human rights-based approach. And so the announcement that's been submitted to the High Court for approval this month is really important, because it will allow courts to have greater regard to rehabilitation for all young people up to 25. But obviously that includes the way in which children who are in the justice system are dealt with. And I think that's really important. I know the committee will be hearing from another roundtable on child justice after this, which I think will be really insightful as well. But the really important focus is getting children out of the criminal justice system and properly respecting and protecting their rights to be seen as children first. And Claire Lighthouler, in her Rights Respecting report, highlighted that 37% of children aged 12 to 17 who've been charged with offences were dealt with in the adult system rather than the children's hearing system. And that goes up to 83% for 16 and 17 year olds. And so until we rectify this, our justice system is going to continue to fail to support and recognise the rights of children as children in the first instance. So,
thank you.
And that's a long answer to your question. It's a good thing, but not fast enough.
Thank you. Thank you. I've got one more question, and it's for Teresa Medhurst. Now, ITV News this week said a series of reports from Berlini prison. I'll ask you more about that later, but in relation to this, the Howard League's submission to this committee talks about an initiative called the Through Care Support Officers Not Being Reinstated, and they describe this as an abdication of responsibility on the part of the Scottish Government. Berlini officer talked quite proudly and passionately about the work he does in liaising with prisoners once they've left prison and how that can be so beneficial. Why is there such a gap between the rhetoric from the Scottish Government and the reality? And will this scheme be reinstated, do you know?
Thank you very much, Mr. Finlay, and you're right to highlight Through Care support and the scheme that was in existence in the Scottish Prison Service up until, I think it was 2019, when there was significant overcrowding and the need to focus staff on operational delivery at that time. There was an evaluation undertaken of the Through Care support scheme, which was highly positive. And the staff who were involved in that scheme brought in real-life experience to share across the service to help our staff understand when people leave custody some of the barriers and difficulties that they face and some of the reasons why we have that revolving door and people continually returning to custody. What I would say is that we are looking at the Through Care support scheme for prisons, and we will consider how best we move forward in relation to both the learning from the initial scheme and other learning from other services across Scotland.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Finlay. Just before I bring in Ms. Mackay, again, I'll just ask witnesses if they can just keep their answers, their responses fairly succinct, and members keep your questioning fairly succinct. We've got quite a lot of subject areas that we would really like to get through today. Thank you. So I'll bring in Ms. Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, and before I ask my questions, can I just put on record how much I agree with what Bruce Adamson's been saying about keeping children out of prison? I think it's a clear-cut situation and it's urgent, and I really want to, for all the reasons that Bruce articulated, I would like to agree with that. My question is about the number of women prisoners. I'd like to direct my questions to Wendy Sinclair-Gibbon and Dr. Katrina Morrison, please. It's nearly 10 years on from Dame Eilish Angelini's report on women offending, and we seem to have made little, if any, progress in terms of women prison numbers. Earlier this month, the total female population was 290, including 93 remand prisoners. We know that women are very often victims of abuse, have experienced trauma, and we know of the disruption this causes to families. I wonder if you could comment on why the numbers are still so high, why you think the numbers are still so high. Are alternatives to custody not being used enough? And maybe just try and highlight why we don't seem to have made a lot of progress in this. Thank you. Could ask Wendy.
Good morning. I'm there. It's
morning.
A delightful question, actually, and it's something that has exercised the inspectorate for some considerable time. When you walk into a women's prison, and I can strongly urge that you all do so, you will find caring and compassionate staff determined to work on a trauma-informed approach and manage the women as best as they can within that parameter. That's not an issue. What stands out when you walk around is the number of women who exhibit or are apparently mentally unwell. And what is clear to me is that if we had a presumption of liberty around women, particularly where they're doing a good job caring for their children, that actually the number of women coming into custody would not be so high. If we could also transfer those mentally unwell women to inpatient care where they're waiting for a bed more rapidly, that would also reduce the number of women coming into custody. And again, you have to look at the remand figures, although they're not anything like as shocking as the children's one. And may I just say that I absolutely agree with Bruce Adamson, and the time to strike is now, not 4 years down the road. We need to get children out of young offender institutions. But aside from that, in terms of women, there are 26% of them are on remand, and about 70% don't go on to receive a custodial sentence. So it beggars the question, beggars belief why they're actually in there anyway. But I would strongly urge the committee to visit Cornton Vale. You will find compassionate and caring staff determined to try and do a good job. There's no question about that. But the level of mental health will appall you.
Thank you.
I think that's all I need to say.
Thank you. Dr. Morrison.
Thank you very much. Yes, thank you for the question. It's also been an issue that we've been raising for a long time at Howard League Scotland. We know, of course, that the women in custody are especially vulnerable. I think there was another written submission which highlighted the number of women with head injuries that have been received, they think mostly through domestic violence as well. And as Wendy also says, you know, the staff do their very best, but it's clear prison is not the right place for these women at all. Most of them also have been sentenced for non-violent offences. And as Wendy also says, many of them are on remand. In terms of the reasons why we keep having the numbers of women in custody that we do, despite, you know, we've had numerous reports dating, well, there was the Angelini Commission, and before that, there were others as well. So this is not new, and it may well be that, you know, some sentencers feel like prison is a place of safety for these people, or a place that they can receive care. And it may be that that's because, you know, there aren't enough secure places in secure healthcare settings for them, which would be more appropriate. It may be because they don't know of other alternatives. We need to be mindful of the temptation to say, okay, we need to create more non-custodial alternatives, and we'll maybe get onto that later. But we know that from the work of Professor McNeill that they have tended to increase alongside the prison population. So we need to be thinking about more systematic diversion away from the system, either at the stage of prosecution or sentencing. And we know that diversion has been very effective for young people, which you'll discuss later on. So it could be that for women, this is something that would be very useful.
Thank you. Just a very brief follow-up to those answers, and thank you for those, are very helpful. Has there been any research done among the judiciary or sheriffs or who are sentencing women as to their reasons for, you know, for giving them custodial sentences? Is it that they feel that there's no not enough care in the community for them? Or, you know, it would be good to know what percentage are in there, because, as you say, it's thought to be a safe environment, which seems, you know, pretty contradictory. Do you know if any research on this has been done in the past, or will it be done in the future?
There's no research looking at the views of sentencers about sentencing women specifically that I know of. One of the things that we have highlighted in our written submission is kind of lack of engagement in policy discussions from the judiciary. And of course, we absolutely support the principle of judicial independence and we want to uphold that. But really, we can't have a discussion about prison's policy without them being round the table as well, when it comes to remand, when it comes to sentencing children or women or indeed sentencing anyone. We really need to hear from them as well. So that is one of our frustrations, is that we don't have that evidence, I'm afraid.
Thank you. Thanks. I completely agree with that. That's me finished, convener, unless anyone else wants to come in.
Anybody else before we move on? No. Thank you very much for that. So thank you for that. We'd like now to move on to some questioning around the modernisation of the prison estate. And I'll bring in Jamie Green, if I may, and then I'll bring in Pauline McNeill after that. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll try and stick to that general theme, but I have some specific questions. I would really like to interrogate Her Majesty's Inspector of Prisons. Thank you for your written submission. It was quite stark, I thought. The first page was painted a rather grim picture of Scottish prisons. You talk about overcrowding, high levels of substance abuse, mental health challenges, and what is described as a fragile organisation with ageing infrastructure and other critical inspections. Given what we now know about the endemic problem of drugs and substance abuse in Scottish prisons, is it the case that we've simply got this wrong in Scotland? We have high remand rates, we have one of the highest incarceration rates in Northern Europe, and prisons in Scotland seem to be a revolving door of drugs, reoffending, and poor mental health outcomes. What are we getting so wrong?
Well, thank you for that question. I'm afraid this is a bit of a hobby horse for me. I think the concept that punishment and prohibition work has never been proven, and that the concept of punishment and prohibition of substance misuse is simply not working. The cycle of reoffending is huge. The distress to families is huge. The difficulties within the community are huge. And I have absolutely welcomed a fair number of reports recently, particularly Dame Carol Black, which says that we need to look at substance misuse as a public health agenda. And I just think we have got it wrong, actually. But we will need to undertake significant change to change that whole concept around, to look at rehabilitation, to look at support in the community, and to remove the presumption of punishment as a way out of it. In other words, offending related to substance misuse that isn't violent, domestic violence, or sexual should not go to prison. It should instead be seen as a public health agenda with considerable support in the community. Now, that requires a significant shift in how we in Scotland deal with substance misuse. From the beginning, when we look at the availability of safe rooms for injecting, where we look at the possibility of community support, and all the way through to a change in the prison rules, where we will not punish people for relapsing. And the way I look at it is, I have a complete addiction to chocolate. I have never succeeded in all my life in overcoming that addiction. Why we assume that punishing people will help them overcome an addiction to a drug is beyond me. And I think we need to rethink our entire strategy.
Thank you for that. I guess that follows.
Reduce the prison population.
Thank you. Yeah. And thank you for your submission. The quote you made is that the choice is stark. We either put fewer people in prison or we recognise that we have to pay for the prison population that we already have. Now, we know that we're not putting fewer people in prison. So does that mean that we're not paying for the prison population that we have?
Yes.
Thank you. Can I ask the Scottish Prison Service specifically, and this follows on from a question from my colleague, we gave around 8,000 prisoners a mobile phone for in-cell use during the pandemic, and there were very obvious reasons for that. Those mobile phones were supposed to be unhackable. Why are so many of them being used to buy drugs in prisons? That question is directed at Ms. Medhurst. Thank you.
Yes, thanks very much, Mr. Green. So the obviously I saw the programme from Berlini. What I would say is that at the start of the pandemic, and particularly the lockdown, we went into a period of time where it was uncertain how long families would not have access to people in custody. And we had never been, we've never faced a situation like that previously. There has always been physical visits arranged for people in custody. So this was unprecedented. We need to at pace, identify other means by which people could maintain family contact, not just to ensure that families who were incredibly concerned and scared for the well-being of their loved ones in custody could be reassured, but also for the mental health of those in custody as well. So the two options that were identified were mobile phones and virtual visits. And at the time, there were strict security criteria that we had to apply and do so at pace with a provider. And I think we implemented the mobile phones in around 4 months. That's unprecedented. You would never do that in normal times, but these were unusual and unprecedented times that we were facing. Since then, obviously, we are aware of some of the areas of vulnerability, and we are working to look at other potential solutions, other, and have continued to look at both our internal security measures as well as technological solutions and minimise risks that exist.
Thank you for that answer. And I think that was a very good answer, which explained the rationale behind the policy, but it didn't quite answer my question. And my question was, why were so many hacked? And the obvious next question is, what will be done about it? Are those 7,600 prisoners being allowed to keep those devices, knowing that many of them, hundreds, perhaps even thousands of them, are being broken and used for illicit purposes in your prison estate?
Sorry, if I didn't answer your question specifically. So I alluded to the fact that we have security measures in prisons. That's why we're able to identify phones that have been tampered with. And where those phones have been tampered with, then there are arrangements to ensure that we apply whatever an appropriate degree of punishment and or withdrawal, depending on the circumstances in which that the nature of the tampering has occurred. And obviously going forward, what we need to do is ensure that any of those risks can be minimised and appropriate measures, additional measures put in place. We also work, I mean, you mentioned obviously specifically in relation to drugs and illicit drugs coming into prisons, but we work very closely with Police Scotland colleagues, particularly around serious organised crime, in order to ensure that all of those risks are minimised and managed as best we can.
Thank you for clarifying that. The theme, I guess, was around modernisation of the prison estate, and this comes back to the the premise of how do we get prison numbers down, and what type of prisons do we build, and how do we best use public money to ensure that the prisons are places that people can come out of adequately rehabilitated and suitably ready for transition back into the community, which I think is something everybody wants. Does any of the panel have a view on that? There are some submissions on what we should do. There's a limited amount, clearly, of public money. There were some announcements in the programme for government, specifically around capital spend on the prison estate. But we know, for example, HMP Greenock or Dumfries, these are old Victorian buildings which it is claimed are breaching human rights simply by the nature of their physicality. What does the Scottish Government need to do, or what do you need the Scottish Government to give you to ensure that the prison estate and the general prison environment is one that is conducive to getting those numbers down and getting criminals back on the straight and narrow. That's an open question to any of the panel. Perhaps you can use the chat function.
Can I perhaps suggest, just in the spirit of timekeeping and also just keeping to our themes if possible, is there maybe, I'm aware that Professor McNeill, you've been quite keen to come in on this. Is this perhaps an opportunity to bring you in?
Thank you very much, convener. I suppose the obvious answer to the question is to say that prisons are a spectacularly bad, or they offer a spectacularly bad return on investment, if you're trying to invest in crime reduction, that is. So prisons, by virtue of imprisoning people, tend to debilitate them, to incapacitate them, to disable them, and to disintegrate them. So when you invest in prisons to try to improve rehabilitation and reintegrating people that go through them, you're spending money to recover from harm that you've created in the first place. So punishment basically is not a smart response to the kind of social problems that have already been discussed in this hearing. You know, problems related to physical and mental health, head injury, substance misuse. The solutions to none of these problems are going to be found in prisons. Rather, prison staff and prison leaders, prison managers, are going to have to struggle against the grain of what imprisonment does to people in order to produce any positive effects. Prisons strip people of liberty, of status, of responsibility, of the capacity to act, of the ability to develop as human beings, and of social connections. And those are the things that help people move away from offending and address many of the social problems that are often associated with offending. So we need to radically rethink how we are spending public resources. When we revert to punishment, because we're a liberal democracy and consider ourselves a civilised nation, we have to create a huge and complex system that applies due process protections before we impose punishment. If we put a much smaller number of people through that system and instead spent the money that we are spending making decisions and then controlling people on providing help to people with social problems, then we would begin to get a significant return on investment. I think any criminologist would tell you that if you want to reduce crime, you invest way upstream of the criminal justice system. And when you do invest in criminal justice, you invest in diversion at every possible turn.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Green, have you got any further questions?
My other question was about parole, but it's not on this theme, so I'm happy to come back in if you can allow me.
Thank you very much. I think we had some earlier questioning around the issue of drugs in prisons, and I think what I'd quite like to do is just quickly jump back to that and allow members to ask some further questions on that, and then we will return to the issue around modernisation for a couple of final questions. So if I may, I'd like to bring in Mr. Finlay again.
Thank you. This is another question for Theresa Medhurst. Now, we all understand the reasons for introducing these mobile phones. We understand the incredible logistical challenge in doing so at pace. But in the ITV news report, one prison officer said that these supposedly tamper-proof devices were hacked, and I quote directly, within hours of their arrival in Berlini. Did you or any of your staff raise this with the Scottish Government? And if so, what consideration was given with disclosing these serious problems to Parliament and or the public?
Thank you very much for your question, Mr. Finlay. So we have, I suppose, over the last year, it's probably been about a year since we introduced mobile phones, continually looked to identify where there were vulnerabilities and seek technological solutions to minimise those vulnerabilities, and worked through that process both between ourselves and colleagues in Police Scotland with our technological provider, as well as ensuring that as we have moved along this journey, clearly that there has been sight of some of those difficulties shared with Scottish Government. I mean, some of this it's clearly operational issues for us to deal with, and I talked about the security measures that we put in place, both for monitoring purposes and to ensure that we are able to identify when phones have been tampered with and therefore withdraw them. And other matters clearly are more around are more policy related, which are government related, around whether or not this kind of service would be continued and what kind of shape that would be continued, whether or not the continuation of something like the mobile phones would be preferred over something which was much more technologically focused, I suppose. So having much more ability to restrict them. So this has been a learning process for us as we've experienced it over the last year. And much of that learning will now be used to inform how best we take the next steps forward as an organisation. And we will do that in conjunction with Scottish Government colleagues.
Thank you. One more question on that issue. It's worth pointing out that the vulnerable prisoners are often targeted by the 600 prisoners who are marked as being members of organised crime groups. Given the security issues you referred to earlier in response to the question from my colleague Jamie Green, I spoke with Peter Smith about some of the other stuff that wasn't broadcast, and what he tells me is the prisoners are now smuggling in seals which allow them to tamper with the phone and then reseal it, which means that on inspection the staff have no way of knowing it's been tampered with. So can you tell us, is there any way you can get the bottom of this or quantify how many phones have been compromised?
That's not information that I have available at the moment, Mr. Finlay. Obviously, I understand Mr. Smith conducted a number of conversations whilst he was in Berlinney. The availability of different means and methods of serious organised crime infiltrating not just our country but our prisons are clearly significant, and that's why we have such close working relationships with colleagues in Police Scotland and work with them fairly intensively around some of the threats and vulnerabilities that poses within our prison system. The dynamics of drugs, not just in prisons, I suppose, but in the country as well, is changing rapidly and clearly is becoming much more and ever more sophisticated. So it's really important for us to ensure that we are as forward-facing as we possibly can be and as up-to-date. That's why we work with a range of experts and organisations to help us better understand the issues around drugs and the problem of drugs in prisons, as well as the measures that we need to take in order to minimise those risks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. If there's no more questions from you, Mr. Finlay, I'll maybe pull the discussion back to yourself, Ms. McNeill. I think you were still looking to ask some questions around the modernisation of the estate.
Thank you, Convener. Probably would be to Theresa Medhurst. So, So Berlini Prison is the largest prison, I understand, in the prison estate. It has had some refurbishment through the years. I've been there, visited a few times before it was refurbished. I was a bit surprised that it's taken so long for the replacement to come around. I mean, given the importance of Berlini to Glasgow and the west of Scotland, a prison that was meant to house mainly short-term prisoners, and I saw from the same piece that was referred to earlier in SDV that continually overcapacity. We cannot possibly meet any of the aspirations that we talked about earlier unless there's the modernisation of prisons. And I just wondered if you could talk me through, I believe it's 2024, 2025 before we see completion of it. I should say I had put down a PQ on this. I'm still waiting on an answer because it seems to me to be quite a delay between, which I know it took some time to secure the land on it, but 2021, 24, 25. I just wondered if you could speak to why it's going to take so long, and I wonder if you would agree that there is an imperative to replace Berlini Prison as soon as possible.
I think that was for Ms. Medhurst, am I correct?
Yes, yeah. That was to the Chief Executive.
Oh.
Can
see if
okay, I think we've perhaps lost Ms. Medhurst.
Do we have, we've got the Alistair.
Alistair, Mr. Purdy, would you be able to pick that up while we try and get Ms. Medhurst back?
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks very much for the question. I think referring to Fergus McNeill's point further down the line, the ideal position would be to stop us bringing people into prison and stop us building a new prison in Glasgow for 1,200 people. But in terms of the date, it's in relation to us being able to secure the land, as you absolutely rightly said, receive the capital money to do that. The design stage has already started, the discussion with and the collaboration with our partners about what it needs to be part of that overall what will be delivered in Glasgow. So that's what's taken the time. The land has been there, the money is now available, and we'll move that forward as quick as we can, going to the design and then through to construction to 2025-26.
So that's my question. Why is it taking so long? Why would it take to 25, 20? I mean, is that just how long it takes to build a prison? It just seems an extraordinarily long timetable. And that means that from 2021 to its five-year period that we're still going to, until we imprison less people, we're going to have the largest prison in the estate, which is over capacity, taking the wrong prisoners, because it's meant to be a short-term prison. It's taking long-term prisoners. We're not able to get people out their cells. What is the explanation for why it would take to 2026? I actually thought it was 2025, but now you're saying it's 2026, yeah. Right.
I think the first thing is to get the capital money to be able to build it. You are able to build a prison in 3 to 4 years from design to construction to opening it. And I think it's securing the capital funding to be able to do that. And that allows us then to move that forward in the time frame we have just discussed.
So you've got the money, but it takes 3 to 4 years to design and build a prison?
Yep.
That's your evidence. So when we built Kilmarnock Prison in Addiewell, it took 4 years to complete. Would that be right?
It takes us three years at least to get it ready, to get it designed, to be able to then have it constructed, then open it and then mobilise. So you're talking about a 3 to 4 year period to do that.
I'm sorry to dwell on this, and obviously I don't know anything. I know a little bit about design of prisons because I do remember the design of Addiewell and Kilmarnock and how they changed the kind of like making it easier for prison officers, lines of sight and all that. That's the case up and down the country then, that from design, it takes 3 years to design a prison, and that would be the same in England or Wales.
No, things can happen simultaneously. So you then have to appoint a contractor, you have to get planning permission, you then have the design agreed, you have that discussion along with the partners about what the establishment needs to do, and then you start the construction phase, and the construction phase typically takes 18 months after that. Then you have the mobilisation, they actually bring the people in, so it takes that period to do that.
Thank you.
And that's our experience from building and opening Low Moss Prison in Bishop Briggs, and building, designing, opening the prison in Grampian up in the northeast.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much for that. I'm going to bring in Colette Stevenson now, and then after that I'd like to bring in Wendy Sinclair, just to see if there's any final comments that you would like to make. So, Colette Stevenson.
Yep, thanks, Convener, and good morning to each and all of you, and thanks for all your really good submissions. I really want to touch on just what Pauline McNeill was commenting on about the prison and the modernisation of it. And it would be remiss of me not to ask the question about going forward, the actual building itself in terms of sustainability and climate change, and whether that's something that's been a part of the talks in terms of where we go forward with Barlinnie as well, and being a more sustainable building, if that's something that's been discussed, and how that's going to look going forward. I sit on the Net Zero Committee, so it was mentioned by Michael Matheson, the Cabinet Secretary, yesterday, and one of the comments that was made, I suppose the buzzword they're using is prosumer, so it's producer-consumer in terms of energy and energy efficiency, so I'd be keen to know that. The other thing as well is, when Pauline McNeill talked about basically the overcapacity in Barlinnie, having been an independent prison monitor up in HMP Shotts previously, one of the biggest requests that I actually got was to do with progression. Okay, so the majority of people within HMP Shotts was high tariff prisoners who were wanting to progress down the prison estate, and the problem they had obviously was overcapacity in Barlinnie, but equally being able to get onto the rehabilitation programmes that are available for them. So I'd be probably put that out to Mr. Purdy, and if Teresa's back on there as well. Thanks.
Mr. Purdy, would you like to respond?
I don't know if Teresa was going to pick that up, but thanks very much for your question. Yeah, I mean, the progression pathway has been impacted by the coronavirus, and the continued number of long-term prisoners that come in through the local prison at Barlinnie and then progress through to Shotts is a consistent pipeline, and that does create a backlog of people who can then move themselves onto the rehabilitative programmes to then start their journey towards the semi-open estate and to the open estate that we have up at Castle Huntly. So it's trying to match the dates that are actually critical for people for the release and for the review through the parole board to make sure that you can do that fairly and consistently. And sometimes it does feel unfair to someone who comes in or has been in custody for a while, and somebody comes in later with a critical date that overtakes that because they have a review in quicker, and they would progress forward and have an opportunity to participate in the programme before someone else. What's that backlog? It has been a problem there before in the pandemic, because that's actually just concentrated that problem.
Sorry, is Teresa not with us? Sorry.
She's back.
Yeah.
Would you like to just pick that up quickly, Ms. Medhurst? Thank you.
So the two things that were asked, Ms. Stevenson, one was about sustainability going with the new builds, and I'd like to reassure you that we do look at all aspects of our new builds in relation to sustainability, carbon zero, etc., and make sure that we are connected into new developments, new technologies and new requirements and legislation. So we try and future-proof as best we can as part of our planning and projections. And then secondly, the issue around progression, as Ali's rightly pointed out, there are issues with progression which have been exacerbated by the pandemic, but there are wider considerations for progression than just prisoner programmes, and we have risk management teams in each establishment that consider the wider risk issues and risk profile of the individual and take that into account as part of that person's progression journey.
Thank you very much, Ms. Medhurst. I think, Ms. Mackay, you've got a couple of questions that you would like to bring in, and then I'll bring in Wendy Sinclair after that.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, it's question to Theresa Medhurst, please. And it's probably to Alistair Purdy as well. It's around the temporary and permanent arrangements for the COVID challenges that you've had. In a previous session, Ms. Medhurst said that family video contact would be being continued when we finally get through the pandemic, which is very welcome. I'm wondering if there's any other, if you could expand on that, if there's any other measures being taken. I know that, you know, the organisation Families Outside are very keen to have the best possible use of technology, for instance, so that a parent can go to a parent night, etc., etc. If you could expand on that, and I'll just tag on my second question so that you could maybe roll them into one. The other one is about the women's custody units, and very much welcome those. We know about the attachment, the importance of attachment between mothers and babies, and I'm just wondering if within those units there will be any planned mother and baby units. I'm not sure if you've got that scoped yet or not, so if you could maybe answer those two, thanks.
Thank you very much. Ms. Mackay, so the issues around the COVID challenges and our ongoing use of technology, there is a digital strategy that we are working on at the moment to increase and enhance both the technological capacity for staff to free up time for them spend on the relationships which are so critical and important in supporting rehabilitation and motivating those in custody to take on board the opportunities that are available to them, but also to expand the range of opportunities for those in custody to access a wider range of supports through technological solutions. And clearly the most important one of those will be through access to families. So that is a critical and central part of that strategy going forward. Secondly, on the community custody units, the community custody units have been designed in a very flexible way to ensure that we have got the ability to support a range of differing needs, which would include obviously mothers and babies as well, because them being close to their home is critically important. So the potential for that to happen has been designed into the facilities that are being developed and built as we speak. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I just follow up briefly with what probability is that is that going to happen? And potential's there, but will it happen? And I'm thinking more on, overnights and stays and things like that, because surely that would really greatly enhance mental health of the women that would be there, and would help with a lot of their problems. Is that something that you think is actually going to happen?
Strongly suggest that we would be failing if it didn't happen. But I think what I would have to say is that we need to be clearly understanding of some of the issues and the factors at play in smaller residential units, ensuring that we take account of everyone's needs within those units, as well as obviously those broader family needs. So, as we always do with children and the ability for children to spend time with their mothers in particular and overnight, we would look at each case on an individual basis and assess it and then identify how best to meet the individual's needs, particularly the points that were made earlier around the rights of the child. So that we need to take cognizance of that, absolutely.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Just before we move on, and I'm quite keen to move on as quickly as we can, we've still got a wee bit to get through. Can I just ask Wendy Sinclair if there's any final comments that you would like to make on this?
Yes, gladly. I think in terms of progression, I think it's worth the committee knowing that HMIPS has undertaken a thematic review on progression, which is basically what happens to people as they walk through their prison journey. Have full cooperation from the Scottish Prison Service, the Risk Management Authority, the Parole Board, and I think we will be able to address some of the issues, find the underlying causes and come up with some recommendations that can resolve this going forward. And Mr. Purdy's exactly right in that the problems existed to some degree before COVID, but were extremely exacerbated by COVID. I would also like to say on substance misuse, I'd really like the committee to look at the evidence around diversion, depenalisation, all of those issues that actually will help us reduce the prison population and hopefully make the replacement of Greenock and Dumfries and even Barlinnie unnecessary, which would be my dream, really. And finally, I absolutely agree with Bruce Adamson. We do need to get the children that are in prison at the moment out. That doesn't mean they don't have to be in secure care. It simply means they shouldn't be in a prison. And I think the committee needs to urgently think through and look at the evidence of that. And I'm really pleased there's an afternoon session on that. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Sinclair. I'm going to move on, if I may. We've just got about 20 minutes left. So again, I would just ask members and witnesses if you can keep your questions and responses as succinct as possible. I'd like us now to focus on the parole system. And I'll bring in Mr. Finlay again just to start our questioning around that.
Yeah, thank you. It's a question for Mr. Watt, and I should declare an interest in that I have recently submitted objections to a prisoner being released who is in custody for attacking myself. In the first line of your submission, you describe the parole board as Scotland's parole court. Can you tell us how the public can attend these courts?
The public can't attend parole hearings. The parole board's a court for very narrow parole purposes. The parole rules as they presently stand tend to mitigate against public attendance at large. There are those with an interest in parole, victims, for example, who can attend, and others can attend for educational purposes or developmental purposes. But it would really need a change in the rules to allow wider access to the public at large. So that's my answer.
Okay.
I would like to be as open as we possibly could be.
Yeah, thank you. Going back to that point, there's perhaps a perception that, you know, anonymous sort of middle-class professionals such as you and I decide the fate of dangerous individuals being returned to the type of communities that we tend not to live in. If sentencing is quite rightly transparent, why is there not transparency around the actual time served? Has the parole board had any discussion with the Scottish Government about moving in this direction?
I don't quite understand the question. Could you
please? The public, as things stand, have no means of knowing when individuals are granted parole. Is there any move involving the parole board and Scottish Government to change that and bring in some increased transparency?
Yeah. Now, the parole board's view is that there is no reason why the release on parole ought not to be made public. For the sake of transparency, I would be quite content to have limited information, perhaps, available on the website, the board's website, covering that kind of thing, unless it had security or safety implications. And there will be cases where you might have to be careful. But otherwise, I see no reason, resources permitting, why that shouldn't happen.
That's good to know. Thank you.
Now, in the second part of your question about discussions, the Management of Offenders Act 2019 restricted itself to information being provided where release in life cases was granted, which is quite a narrow band of publicity, if you like, and a very limited number of cases. It also required complete anonymity, and that's the law, so we apply it.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Watt. I'll bring in Mr. Green now, and then I'd like us to move on to looking at care of prisoners. Mr. Green, thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I have a supplementary to the line of questioning on parole, and I indicated I have a separate question on alternatives to custody, but I'm happy to keep that if we have time, because we haven't really discussed that as a panel today. We know that numbers on the victim notification scheme are dropping year on year. Now, at the moment, that's an opt-in service, but it is clear, and I note very vividly from the submission from the Parole Board for Scotland that the word victim wasn't mentioned once in your paper. Isn't that the root of the problem here, in that the entire submission is primarily centred around how we make parole better for those involved in the hearings, i.e. those in prison, and no mention is made by anyone in their submissions about how we better improve the victim notification scheme proactively, so that we are telling those who were affected by those serious crimes that the people who perpetrated them are now back in, out in the street, so that they're not bumping into them in the queue in a supermarket.
The board is committed to providing as much information as possible to victims. Now, I'm due to appear before a round table next Wednesday, and there's a very lengthy paper consisting of, what, 6 pages about the parole board's desire to assist victims so far as possible for the next hearing. But the focus of this hearing was not victims. I'm very happy to talk about victims and how we would like to support them. We go above and beyond what statutory requirements we have. We arranged for attendance of victims at a hearing some considerable time ago now at Greenock, before there was ever a statutory requirement, and we did it in person. I chaired that particular tribunal. So it's perhaps unfair to castigate us for not mentioning victims when we're scheduled to do that next week. But if you've got some specific questions, I'm happy to deal with them. But the board has to be as open as it possibly can be, provide victims with as much information as it can, as much support as it can, whether it does it directly or through other, perhaps better qualified bodies is an open question. But I agree with the sentiment of your question. Victims must understand what's happening.
Thank you. I'm sure we'll have that discussion in due course at a future panel. I look forward to reading your paper. Convener, would you like me to ask some other question now, or allow other members?
I'm quite keen, if we may, to just move on to looking at care of prisoners and death in custodies.
Sure, that's important. Yeah,
if we may. And in that regard, I'll bring in Ms. Stevenson to start that off. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Again, I had previously alluded to the fact that I was an independent prison monitor, and one of the things that we inspected was the NHS and the health of prisoners as well. And one of the other things that stood out for me as well when I went down to visit the healthcare suite within Shots was that most prisoners were allocated their prescription drugs on a Friday, which was quite concerning because it led to a lot of them kind of sharing it. They were locked up over the weekend as well with very little in the way of purposeful activity. There was no educational facilities over the weekend as well. And so it became a currency, in effect, for changing over drugs or swapping drugs and whatnot as well. And the other thing was at risk of overdose as well for some people who were suffering from varying degrees of mental health. And one of the things the Minister for Drug Prevention, Angela Constance, mentioned was about maybe a slow release injection that can be given by the NHS. What I would like to know from Wendy and I think probably Teresa as well, what is has that changed? And if so, you know, are the NHS still giving that dispensing drugs on a Friday, literally in the afternoon? And is there any way that can be changed? And the other thing as well is slow, you know, injections, slow release drugs, so that there's no risk to the prison population in terms of overdoses, and also getting involved in the currency and obviously the challenges that, you know, are faced with drugs in prisons. Thanks.
Well, thank you. That's an interesting question. I think it's important to mention that the drug you mentioned by injection is Buvidal, and basically it is highly regarded by both the prisoners and the staff because it does remove that risk of being bullied out of your drugs, or of when you leave prison not having it stolen as you leave the prison. So we view Buvidal as a good success story, if you like. There are problems. Prisoners tell us the fog that comes with methadone in their brains, they feel that has lifted under Buvidal. And so all in all, it's a success story. Drugs in prison is a major, major issue. And when I talk about revising the prison rules, one of the things that needs to happen is a reduction of the drugs coming in through the post in almost undetectable quantities. So the prisons are phenomenal at detecting and preventing drugs. When you look at the reports of how much they stop getting into prison, it's amazing. But for example, the novel psychoactive drugs can go on paper. If they can forge a solicitor's letter, then on paper, soak it in drugs, which can then be popped in the kettle and sent out, you've got a real problem. So by changing the prison rules, we can prevent at least all legal letters coming in by post, and we can actually look at perhaps photocopying prisoner letters. But you're always playing a catch-up game with drugs. You know that from being an IPM. You know, it's a major problem in prison. It's a major problem stopping it coming in. It's a major problem providing support and rehabilitation to prevent people wanting to take drugs. So I know that it's a huge issue for the prison service, and the recovery model is something that you'll find the afternoons committee can discuss at length as well. But it does need to move to a recovery model.
Thank you. Is that
thank you very much, Ms. Stevenson, for the question. I think we are aware, and so there are, you will know from your time as an IPM, you know, different means and mechanisms by which arrangements are made to ensure that either people who are vulnerable from having in-person medication, then different arrangements are made for them. But the issue around the slow release Buvidal, as Wendy says, definitely has got much more potential to minimise both the risks to individuals as well as ensuring that people can be better supported on that recovery journey. And Wendy's right, anecdotally, the information coming back is that people are much more able to focus on rehabilitation and release in a way that they find difficult with methadone, when they're on methadone. So if you're asking, has it changed? I mean, there is still an awful lot of prescribed medication that goes out in prisons every single day, and it very much drives how we operate our prisons because of the amount of time that takes. So it really would be for health service and the NHS to speak to this, but really anything such as Buvidal, we would really welcome warmly, both in terms of making more time available for rehabilitation and also ensuring that those risks can be minimised. In terms of recovery and the arrangements that Wendy was referring to, psychoactive substances have been a game changer, I think, for everyone. And the methods and means by which people can traffic those are quite well known for the most part, but it is being able to put in place, and we are currently considering other measures that we can take, particularly around mail coming into to prisons, so that we can minimise those risks as much as possible. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Anything else you'd like to pick up on?
No, I wanted to maybe touch upon the mail in terms of electronic mail, and that you can now email a prisoner rather than actual, you know, hard mail coming through. But I suppose that depends on the volume as well, and just how much that's getting used. But I'm conscious as well of the time, so it's something I could maybe write to yous about and ask if that's okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and thank you for those responses. Could I bring in Fulton McGregor? I know that you were quite keen to ask some questions around purposeful activity in prisons and the sort of transition phase into the community. Mr. McGregor?
Thanks, Convener, and thanks for that. Actually, Fergus McNeil touched on my area of question earlier, and I know he's been waiting from the chat to come back in, so I'll give him an opportunity here. And I'd like to say from the outset that I concur completely with what he said earlier in terms of where the balance should be as we move forward in terms of the society that we want to become. So I suppose my question for panellists, starting with Mr. McNeil, is what can the impact be of rehabilitation services within prisons, whether that's those that the prisons provide themselves, or those that are outsourced, if you like, either to third sector organisations or local authority workers or NHS workers? And what impact do you think that the COVID-19 pandemic has had in this, particularly the outsourcing of services? Thanks. Quite a broad question, but thanks.
Sorry, did you mean me to come in on that now? First of all,
yes. If you want to come in first, I know you've been looking to come back in anyway, Professor. So you can bring in any other points that you wanted to raise.
I'll try to be very brief, but I'll put on the record what I put on the chat was, which was a sense of frustration that when we talk about modernising the prison estate and responding to problems like problems with mobile phones or the problems with psychoactive substances, it feels to me as if we're talking about redecorating the house and buying new furniture when a structural engineer has told us that the foundations are collapsing. And if you read the submissions to the committee carefully enough, you'll see in them that there's lots of criticism of the foundations on which our system is built. Having made that point and put it on record, obviously rehabilitation in prison is really difficult, and the evidence about rehabilitative programs is that they work better in the communities than in prisons. And there's an obvious reason for that. You can try to learn something in an institutional environment, but the first thing that you have to do when you're released is transfer the learning to a new context. And that's difficult for, I don't know, social work students on placements or medical students moving from universities to hospitals. The transfer of learning is a complicated activity, and prisoners are not well supported in that transition. Take the learning from inside out into the community. One way that we can ease with the transfer of learning is by ensuring that it happens through partnerships with outside organisations. And clearly, criminal justice social work and the third sector, educational institutions and health services have a huge role to play there. So the short answer is that if we are to try to rehabilitate in prisons, which I think is not the best strategy, but if we are to try to do it in prisons, then we have to do it through developing partnerships. I'll say one more thing. If you overcrowd prisons, then you cannot provide meaningful rehabilitation. And the Committee for the Prevention of Torture tells us repeatedly that our prisons are overcrowded. So again, we can't dress this up in any different way. We don't rehabilitate prisoners well, and we don't prepare them for release well, and we don't support them on release well. And it's because our system is chock-a-block with people that shouldn't be in it. That's the first and fundamental problem that we need to address. But I'll shut up and let others in after saying that.
Yeah, thanks, Professor. I think before I come to a couple of others that have put ours in the chat box, You know, I would say that I completely agree with that. I think that we are sending too many people to prison currently, and I think there is definitely a job of work to be done. But I am also consciously aware that this particular session is on the prison estate. So on that basis, I wanted to come to Alan, I think was next, and maybe talk about how do you think that the pandemic has impacted work that has has been able to take place within prisons, as I said, whether that's what prisons provide themselves or external people coming in.
Thank you for that question. It's been very, very interesting in terms of how a lot of organisations have responded to this through changing to remote forms of working, through to variations on gate liberation work and so forth. But you can't deny that access has been the key thing, the face-to-face relationship building, which is essential, has been the key loss over this whole COVID period, getting access. And we talk about rehabilitation, and perhaps we forget that the single most important factor in rehabilitation is hope. If you don't have hope, there's not a lot of point rehabilitating. And in order to create hope, you have to have a pathway. You have to have some sort of sense that there is a life, there is a future outside of the prison. So we can't really afford to continue to keep treating prison as some kind of subset of humanity or a silo on its own. It's part of a journey. And the third sector have been very, very efficient and effective in creating an in-reach process. But that's nowhere near complete. It's nowhere near available everywhere. Funding has been a particular issue. And committee members may or may not be aware that at the beginning of next year, the European social funding stops. European social funding has been the one source of funding which has allowed organisations like ours to work specifically with people with additional needs, for instance, people with sexual offence records, domestic violence, group of the prison population, and that group of people has not been recognised in terms of the additional responses that we need to put in place to allow them to transition safely and effectively into the community. So rehabilitation, absolutely, the third sector is capable of doing a lot of this work. We just need to be involved, I think.
Thank you, Alan. I know that we are running out of time. I think those two other people wanted to come in, Dr. Katrina Morrison and John as well. I wonder if you could just pick up very briefly on the question that I raised, and perhaps bring in, I know that Rona Mackay talked about it in the context of women's prisons, but in more general terms, the importance of family contact and rehabilitation and how that can be done safely. And convener, at that point, I'll ask no more further questions in the interest of time.
Am I first?
Yeah.
Katrina
Morrison, do you want to come in?
Thank you very much. I'll be as brief as possible. Quickly, I absolutely agree with Fergus's point about rehabilitation in prison. It's not the place that we should be rehabilitating, given that then when you enter into the community, you're just trying to undo the many of the damages that have been done. Also about overcrowding, it's impossible or much harder to do anything positive in a context in which everything's overcrowded. I just wanted to make the point about work, and there's actually a real opportunity in some ways with work at the moment and providing skills and potentially qualifications for people in custody in the context of the very significant labour shortages that there are. We all will have read about these. They currently exist in construction and joinery and catering, etc. So with real concerted effort and partnership working with organisations and community partners, there's a potential here to allow people to gain the skills in sectors in which there are jobs in the future. And that will certainly give them a lot of hope, echoing Alan's point for the future. Also, this work should be properly remunerated. So there are many jurisdictions in which people in custody are actually paid properly for the work that they do. In Italy, this is also taxed, meaning that it generates revenue, which can then go back into the system. And this sort of feeling of earning an income is something that can really help that individual as well. They can send some of that money back to their family. It can provide them hope for the future. So there's lots of things to consider there in terms of work, I think.
Thank you very much. And I think, Mr. Watt, if I may ask you just to be as brief as you can, and then I'll bring the session to a close. Thank you.
Okay. If I can just say briefly, the parole system in this country is wasteful. Delays in rehabilitative programmes and the consequences after that evaluation, permission to go into the community and waiting for a place in the open estate can potentially add 2 years to the point in time when a prisoner can realistically be considered for parole. That's 2 years in itself, where that's perhaps unnecessary. And echoing previous comments about community alternatives, we should be searching for proportionate ways to restrict liberty. And that really means there should be options in the community which are proportionate to the risk, where custody in a prison is perhaps not proportionate to the risk. And that may well allow more prisoners to be released and fewer prisoners to be recalled into custody. But without that proportionate restriction on liberty in the community, the choice is a binary one. It's either in the community or in jail, and that's inflexible and results in people being in prison who really shouldn't be there. I'll stop at that.
Thank you very much, Mr. Watt. I know we probably didn't get through a lot of the questions and responses that we would have liked to, so I would just extend an invitation to witnesses. If you would like to raise any outstanding points with the committee, please do feel free to contact us in writing, and we will very much take your evidence into account. So I'd just like to extend my thanks to all our witnesses today. Thank you very much for your contributions. And we'll now take a short 5-minute break before we hear from our next set of witnesses. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, members. Our next agenda item this morning is a roundtable discussion about reducing youth offending, offering community justice solutions and alternatives to custody, and I refer members to papers 5 and 6. We will take evidence today from a roundtable of witnesses who will be joining us virtually. And I'm sorry that you cannot join us in person, but this is due to the current rules around social distancing. I warmly welcome our panel of witnesses this morning. We have Ms. Fiona Dyer, Interim Director of the Children's and Young People's Centre for Justice, Ms. Gemma Fraser, Senior Reporting Officer, Recovery, Renewal and Transform, Community Justice Scotland, Ms. Ashley Cameron, the Promise Scotland Oversight Board Member, the Care Review, Superintendent Colin Convery, Partnerships, Prevention and Community Wellbeing of Police Scotland, Ms. Diane Dobie, Justice Standing Committee of Social Work Scotland, Professor Leslie McCara of the University of Edinburgh, and Dr. Hannah Graham, Senior Lecturer in Criminology at the University of Stirling, and finally Mr. Niven Rennie, Director of the Scottish Violence Reduction Unit. We very much appreciate your time joining us this morning, and I thank those witnesses who have provided a written submission. These are now available online. I intend to allow around about an hour or so for questions and discussion. If witnesses wish to respond to a question, can I ask that you indicate that request by typing an R in the chat function on BlueJeans, and I will bring you in if time permits. If you're merely agreeing with what the witness is saying, there's no need to intervene to say so. Other comments you make in the chat function will not be visible to committee members or recorded anywhere. So if you would like to make a comment, please do so by requesting to speak. So we'll now move directly to questions. Can I please ask members and our invited guests, as ever, to keep questions and comments as succinct as possible. I'm very keen to encourage as free-flowing a discussion as I can. So I would like to start off our question session this morning and perhaps start with... just have a look here. I'd like to start with Gemma Fraser from Community Justice Scotland, and then I'd like to bring in Fiona Dyer, if I may. Obviously, this morning, the Scottish Sentencing Council published a new guideline on the sentencing of young people, and this guideline, if it's approved, will apply to the sentencing of all those under the age of 25 years and will require the courts to consider rehabilitation issues and the availability of a range of non-custodial options. So whilst I appreciate that members and witnesses won't perhaps have had time, a great deal of time to consider this, I was just interested to ask, particularly our representative from Community Justice Scotland in the first instance, if you welcome this report, and what difference, if any, do you think that it will make? So I can maybe start off with Ms. Fraser.
Yes, thank you very much. I think we would happily welcome what's being proposed today as within Community Justice Scotland and for wider community justice delivery. For a long time, we have put forward the case that individuals are exactly that, that they are individual and bring their own experiences to the table in terms of offending as the product of that. Wherever this can be considered and how they are sentenced for young people or across our adult population is of huge benefit. And what it should do and support is the ability to access the correct services at the correct time in the system. The more community that we can put into justice, the better, because we already understand that networks, relationships and connection are what truly changes lives, and that is true of young people as it is more so probably than any other. Where we can have more individuals within community orders as a result of this, with more access to education and those early supports that is hugely welcomed, absolutely.
Thank you very much. At this point, maybe bring in Ms. Dyer just to make any further comments that you'd like.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Yes, I'd echo what Gemma has just said there. We would welcome these changes and the proposals made, especially in relation to remittal to the children's hearing system. Currently, only an average of 7 or 8% of children who appear in adult courts are remitted to the children's hearing system. And as you'll know, this is a system where they actually can participate and their needs are taken into account. So we'd welcome that especially, but also that young people, their needs are being recognised up to age 25. We know the evidence with brain development, and we know about the complexities that many young people in our justice system face. Speech, language and communication needs, brain development, brain injury and other issues and traumas that they have faced in their life. So for these to be taken into account when sentencing is being made is definitely a welcome decision. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Ms. Dyer. And I'd just like to ask a follow-up question, again, both to Ms. Fraser and I'll bring in Ms. Dyer. Obviously, given the important principle of judicial independence, I'm just interested in how or what you think about how that will be implemented throughout Scotland and not perhaps applied only in a few sort of areas or sort of sheriffdoms. We've already seen from the work of Audit Scotland that sentencing data shows some geographical variation in the use of community sentences. So, for example, the number of CPOs per 10,000 population in 2019 to 2020 ranged from 16 in East Renfrewshire to 69 in Clackmannanshire. So I'm just interested, I'll maybe start with yourself, Ms. Fraser, if you've got any sort of commentary or response around that. Thank you.
Yeah, I think it's important to note in terms of geographical variance that areas do not experience the same types of crime and offending and do not therefore need the same responses. I think it's important to take those figures in a context of how many individuals are in custody, how many individuals are diverted, thus getting earlier access to the system or could be brought closer into the system. I think where we need to think about judicial impartiality, that is a hugely important thing in Scotland. And it should be preserved because it supports a system that is hugely admired across the world. However, how we ensure that not just the judiciary but the public have confidence in what is being delivered in communities is about our effective communication of what sits and underpins community justice. So in order to ensure those things come through and aren't used in a small subset of individuals, we have to make sure those lines of communication are open with our community justice deliverers, but also the individuals who experience community sentences and the benefits that they've received from that. I think this goes a long way to helping these things be promoted and put into place at the right times. Certainly in Community Justice Scotland, we've supported an information project at the moment in order to achieve that, but it's also how we influence Crown Office, defence agents and other individuals in thinking about decision making and what might be suitable for those individuals who receive it.
Thank you very much. I'll bring in Ms. Dyer just now, and I'll bring in following that. I'll maybe ask Hannah Graham to come in. So, Ms. Dyer.
Thank you. Yes, I agree again with what Gemma said. Although I think it's important, there is differences in decision making, and we've seen that with some of the research we've undertaken at the Children and Young People Centre for Justice in relation to bail and remand, supervised bail, and what sentencers believe is appropriate and how many chances some young people may or may not get. So hopefully the sentencing guidelines will be supported by training and sort of potential guidelines for the judiciary so that we can involve some consistency in relation to decisions that are being made, because I think that's also important.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. Ms. Graham, would you like to come in and then I'll bring in, I'm just trying to keep things moving smoothly, and then I'll bring in Professor McCara after that. Mm-hmm. So, Ms. Graham.
Thank you, Convener. Views that I'm expressing in the roundtable today are as a criminologist who works in academia.
So I'm not officially speaking for the Scottish Sentencing Council, but I should declare an interest that I hold a public appointment as a member of the Scottish Sentencing Council. And in the panel of witnesses in the roundtable earlier and just now, many of the points that we'd want to see raised have already been raised. And so the council development of the Sentencing Young People Guideline has been informed by a range of evidence. There's been research commissioned. There has been public and judicial consultation, and so the experience and the expertise not only of organisations and lived experiences such as those represented in the roundtable today, but a much wider range of groups, bodies, academics, members of the public have contributed towards this consultation. The points that I would add to what's already been said, and Gemma Fraser summarised some of the key issues and opportunities quite well, is that the guideline has been drafted quite carefully, not to limit judicial discretion, but to guide in determining an appropriate sentence. So it requires sentences to consider the purpose of rehabilitation in sentencing young people, but it does not stop or preclude other sentencing purposes if they are relevant. So if public protection is relevant, or if punishment is relevant, the judiciary are not stopped or limited in considering those. And if it's approved by the High Court, the guideline will apply to approximately 14,000 cases of young people per year, and there's a potential for an increase in community sentencing for particularly the age 21 to 24-year-old age group, as well as potentially more review hearings in courts. And that would be an example where the judiciary might have imposed something like a community payback order, and to encourage and monitor compliance, a young person might be brought back before the court with input from justice, social work, and relevant others to consider how they are complying with that order, because that could be a shorter order or it could be anywhere up to 3 years. So this is encouraging more rehabilitative outcomes in the hope of reducing reoffending, which hopefully means fewer victims in future. And victims groups and their representatives have also been part of the consultation, the engagement, the research commissioned by the council. So it's been a large undertaking, and if people would like to know more, there's a lot of information on our website, and an impactful assessment will be released after High Court consideration.
Thank you very much. Professor McCara, would you like to come in?
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you very much for inviting me to give evidence today. So most of my evidence is going to be based on the findings from our longitudinal study, the Edinburgh Study of Youth Transitions and Crime, that Susan McVie and I have been running for the last 23 years. We've been following the same people for that period of time. They're now aged 35, so we've followed them since age 12, and we now have the beginning results of phase 8 of our study. So some of the things I want to say are related to that longer term information about people's journeys through life up to that age. But I want to begin, first of all, by saying in 1992, my first job was in the Scottish Office as a researcher and evaluating the implementation of ring fence funding for community justice, social work, criminal justice services, with the ambition at that time that they would reduce short-term imprisonment. And the policy in some levels was successful, but it was not successful in reducing the prison population. And the principal reason for that was because sheriffs and judges continued to give short-term sentences, feeling they had no alternative and not feeling tremendously confident in community disposals. So I absolutely welcome the Sentencing Council's recommendations and guidelines today, absolutely welcome them. But the proof of the pudding will be if actually they are absorbed and followed by the sentence that people who are able to sentence. So that's one thing that's really important, that when we want to transform the prison population, when we want to transform what happens to people in Scotland, you have to think about what the judiciary is doing, always accepting that we have to have an independent judiciary, but they are the gatekeepers to the criminal justice system in terms of disposals in the community or in prison. So that's one thing. Second of all, there's very compelling research now, as I know that it's been drawn to the committee's attention, about brain development, neurodevelopment, neuroscience developments, looking at the how children mature and how up to age 24 the brain is still maturing, and that therefore, because of those sort of biological considerations, that rehabilitation seems to be the most just approach to dealing with young people who come into conflict with the law. But there are other also contexts of the lives of young people that mean that actually the court setting is simply not appropriate for 16 and 17 year olds. 10 years ago, I also gave evidence to a justice committee about trying to extend, make sure that although the hearing system can technically deal with 16 and 17 year olds, it very rarely does, and trying to extend something, a different kind of venue to deal with children who come in conflict with the law at 16 and 17. And I still think that is absolutely needed. We have some of the most vulnerable children make the transition into the adult system. They get up very quickly, that is shown by our study, and the longer term outcomes are very poor for them. So the conundrum of how we manage older children in justice systems has yet to be solved by the Scottish system.
Thank you very much, Professor McCarra. That was very helpful. I'm going to ask Fulton McGregor to come in now. I think he's just got a couple of general questions around violence reduction, and then I'll move on to looking at alternatives to custody, and I'll bring in Rona Mackay. So Fulton McGregor, can I hand over to you?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Yes, I've got just a very general question, I think, just from the own line of questioning, and it's on the sort of Scotland's approach to youth offending. And I wanted to ask, from the violence reduction unit perspective, what we can learn from that, because I know that the work done by that team is absolutely fantastic. But what can we learn from that in terms of their approach to youth offending, which I do think has many positives in it, as someone who used to work in that sector as well, you would expect me to say that. But what can we learn from the Violence Reduction Unit in its approach in terms of a public health message and basis to our work? And if I could start maybe with Niven Rennie, if that would be okay.
Thank you. So can I just say thank you for the opportunity to speak to you as well. So a lot of things involved in that. Firstly, public health, a recognition that the answer to our problems doesn't lie with justice and the police alone, that we all have to play a part, that many people start their journey into criminality, journey into violence pre-birth, and best picking up on the last point, that you know, we know from work that we've done about adverse childhood experience and the impact of growing up in this. So I totally agree that interventions need to be earlier, and we need to try and keep people out of prison, because we've shown people we're working with, people who work for me now, who have had a history of offending, who can turn their lives around in a couple of years and start taking other people out of that criminal justice journey. So there's so much I could talk about going through the rest of your time, but hopefully that touches on some of the issues.
Yeah, thanks for that. I think that is a very helpful oversight. I'm wondering if MDLs, maybe Superintendent Convery, if you wanted to come in on that and perhaps expand on the points there made by Niven about how important do you think it is that that we do take into account all the different factors, and that child welfare is taken into account in dealing with youth offending in a human rights approach, as you probably heard Bruce Adamson talk about in the previous panel.
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Mr. McGregor, and with the convener. From our perspective, absolutely support the comments that Niven's offered in terms of the trauma-based approach. Something that we absolutely believe in as an organisation, something we're working towards, and I think that runs through all the legislative pieces that are developing just now and delivery to support youth justice, ranging from UNCRC incorporation, the promise, the vision of youth justice strategy, age of criminal responsibility, etc. So there's lots of moving parts, and I think that's a fantastic opportunity just now to try and pull things together. But I do think that looking at the wider vision and the sort of public health approach to things is absolutely the right way to support our young people. And I'm aware of the Sentencing Council announcement this morning, which we would obviously support, given the fact that it's about trying to underpin and undermine and sort of fix the challenges that young people are facing in their life to try and prevent the offending in the first place. And the fact that it's up to 25 recognise again the trauma-based aspect. And the one bit that I know Niven has worked a lot on and that we would advocate is the lived experience aspects and actually engaging and listening and understanding service users' perspectives and views, clearly also about witnesses. And maybe one of the challenges we do face is balancing up that between justice and welfare and how we meet and manage community expectations to try and deliver and maintain confidence. So I think there's a lot. I absolutely agree with you. UNCRC offers huge opportunities, and as an organisation, we're totally committed to a rights-based approach. And I would like to think that's the direction we'll go as an entity, and I'm sure collectively we'll all work towards that.
Yeah, thanks very much for that, Superintendent. Diane Dobby, I'm wondering if I can bring you in on this as well, but just picking up on that point that was made there by Superintendent Confrey, I mean, I think that is a really important issue. In terms of sometimes some of our young people who are displaying the most challenging behaviour in our communities, you know, and are affecting their communities really badly, often are some of our most traumatised young people as well. And you know, I wonder if you could comment how important you think that balancing is that's been referred to there, and how we can get that right and make sure that welfare and human rights approach for our children is at the centre.
Okay, thanks for the opportunity to respond to that question. I think from a Social Work Scotland point of view, young people who are in conflict with the law really have unmet needs, and Social Work Scotland would also kind of acknowledge the research in relation to brain development and that children and young people's brains aren't fully developed until they are at the age of 25. Also that many young people who are either on the edges of the justice system or involved in justice services have experienced some level of trauma or some level of adversity, and that they're all individuals. The whole system approach that was introduced in 2011, I think, has already demonstrated and some really good outcomes for some young people. But I think the challenge is in relation to some of our older young people, ensuring that they get the right help at the right time and that responses are proportionate, trauma-informed, and they're child-centred, that young people don't fare well in the adult justice system, so where at all possible that they are kept out of adult justice services through being remitted, well, through early and effective intervention in the first instance, through being remitted to the hearing to ensure that they get a multi-agency sort of child-centred approach and a plan that's responsive to their needs, that they're diverted from custody. And for those young people who are posing a significant or imminent risk of harm, that we use child-centred response to that, and that we do not put young people in custody, and that we would, where possible, use secure. But there are some of legal barriers to the use of secure care at the present time, which I think have been acknowledged in some of the written evidence that's been submitted. For over 18s, they're still pretty young, as I think the research evidences. You know, they're not fully developed, they're not fully mature. If they're on a community payback order, it's often a real challenge to get a young person like that to comply with that, because at times their maturity means that they're testing boundaries, they're taking challenges, they're taking risks. So in order to support that, there needs to be a multi-agency, flexible and responsive approach to supporting that young person. which involves all agencies who are involved with them. Some of the experiences that have worked well, or some of the interventions that have worked well, have probably been like the structured deferred sentencing approaches for young people who have been convicted of an offence, but they haven't yet been sentenced. And there's a level of flexibility within that, but they're also basically they can go up to review courts on a regular basis where the progress is monitored, and there is certainly flexibility within that to respond. And there's some evidence that there's been like some positive outcomes for young people who've gained greater citizenship through that intensive support that's been delivered. Thanks.
Thank you for that, Convener. I'm happy with that in terms of a general opening question, because I do have a question later. There is three people here wanting in, but I will return to you to decide if that's appropriate or not at this stage, given the time. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'd like to bring in Professor McCarra again, and then followed by Fiona Dyer, just to pick up on this topic.
Thanks very much. One of the things that we should be celebrating in Scotland are the major reductions in young people aged 16 and 17 in custody. It would be good to get that into zero, but it's very much lower than it was. Huge reductions since the introduction of the whole system approach. Equally, reductions in criminal convictions in 16 and 17-year-olds. So there's a really very strong set of trends in the criminal justice statistics that are downward trends, that are some in some degree indicative that the diversionary approaches are working, and that's very pleasing for me, actually, because our study, the Edinburgh study, was one of the pieces of evidence drawn on to give the government confidence that it could do something like diversion and it would work, and it, in some level, it is working. But what those aggregate figures are disguising is something I'm sure most people on this call are aware of, is that the system is now dealing with a smaller number of young people, but they're much more intensely vulnerable. It's an intensely vulnerable group, particularly the young people who end up in Polmont. It's intense vulnerability, and therefore they are absolutely the most challenging, the most difficult young people who are suffering from extremely difficult circumstances. Our study, we have been following the trajectory of our young people up to age 35. And we've been able to do what's called trajectory modelling, which is where you can look at different patterns of offending. And we have a group of young people in our cohort, not very many, who are in this very high level, chronic level of self-reported offending, who are intensely involved in offending. And for those young people, and actually for many of the young people who become persistent offenders, whether it's serious offending or less serious offending, they come from the poorest backgrounds. And the young people that we have in our cohort now who are still having criminal convictions, a very small proportion, are intensely poor, intensely difficult backgrounds. And one of the things I think in justice that we leave as the elephant in the room is poverty. Poverty is it underpins the lives of so many of the young people who get caught up in the justice system. And we never deal with this problem holistically. We don't look in the round. We look at it in terms of the individual family, or we look at housing, or we look at jobs, but we never look at the way in which all of these are intersectional issues. And we see that poverty is the thing that leads to chronic patterns of offending. It's very strongly predictive of chronic patterns of offending. It also is the thing that stops people stopping offending. So most people desist from offending in their early 20s. What we see in this small group of people who continue to offend into their 30s is that they are trapped by poverty, trapped by poor skills, trapped by not having a strong education, trapped being excluded from school earlier on, and they cannot break free. And I think until we start thinking about rehabilitation and youth justice in that broader holistic context, we will continue to see these highly vulnerable young people coming to the system. And they're very, very difficult to support and help, because the context in which they're living are the things that trap them and do not allow them to move on.
Thank you very much. And I'll just bring in Fiona Dyer, briefly, if you wouldn't mind, and then we'll move on. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Yes, I think the difficulties that these children are facing, and I think there are fewer of them in the system, which is great, but their needs, especially for children up to 18, will be best met in the children's hearing system. And I think in Scotland, what we need to do is look at our legislation. Because we've got so many contradictions in legislation about who is a child and where their needs can be best met, that's why we've got so many children in our adult court system. And ultimately, if we're going to be UNCRC compliant, children should not appear in any adult court, and that is children up to age 18. But at the moment, because a child is deemed as an adult if they are 16 and 17 and not open to the children's hearing or on compulsory supervision, those children, if they are needing to have their needs met in a secure environment, they cannot be sent to secure care. They have to go to our young offenders institution because of legislation. They also, as I say earlier, the low numbers that are remitted to the children's hearing system. So ultimately what we need in Scotland is a system where all children are treated as children, and the children's hearing system has the supports in place to deal with all children up to age 18. And then the sentencing council's new guidelines would be really fitting for those over 18 and up to 25 to take their additional needs into account. But until the legislation changes are made, children will still appear in adult court from age 12 in Scotland, and that's something I think we need to change.
Thank you very much indeed. If there are no more questions, I'm just quite keen to move on and start to have a look at alternatives to custody and diversion from prosecution, and I'll maybe bring in Ms Mackay before we move on to community sentencing.
Thank you, Convener. I think Professor Leslie McCara and some of the other witnesses have, you know, talked about this, and I think maybe given it in previous answers that why it should happen and the reasons possibly why it isn't happening, and I do agree with them. If I may, can I move on to the provision of secure care, which we've just been talking about as well? I'd like to explore the area of secure care generally as an alternative to incarceration in prisons or in young offenders institutions. I know that you probably heard powerful evidence from Bruce Adamson in the earlier round table saying that children should never be in prison, and I agree with that, and I suspect others do too. Fiona Dyer and Ashley Cameron, I'll come to you. Your submissions stated that you have great concern about this, pointing out that these settings are not appropriate for children, and they certainly don't reflect the recommendations and the promise or the whole system approach or GERFEC. And we do know that children in these settings can often result in very tragic circumstances. If I could maybe come to Ashley first. Your submission was quite powerful, very powerful on this. And if you could maybe give your thoughts behind, why secure care, which is, can offer a holistic setting and it can offer training for young people, etc., and trauma-informed care. If you think, if you can give your thoughts on that, and then maybe Fiona Dyer could come in. And then Fiona and Diane Dobby have both said there are barriers to secure care, so I would just like to tease that out a wee bit, barriers through legislation. But if I could come to Ashley first, please.
Hi there, and thanks for the opportunity to speak at the committee today. I think the reason why the promise and formally the independent care review have issues regarding secure care is, quite rightly, as you said, sometimes it has tragic consequences. It can actually lead to the further criminalisation of young people. But also, there are quite a few issues with the kind of secure care we are talking about. We may define it in law as somewhere that's secure for these young people to be and to rehabilitate. But actually, the young people's experience of secure care is very different. Where their privileges are completely taken away from them, and a lot of young people, care experienced young people, had told the care review that actually it feels just like a prison. And if that's what we're doing to our young people, then we are doing it very, very wrong. There is also further issues regarding secure care, such as cross-border placements. which have come up time and again at the Scottish Parliament. Young children being moved from England to secure care places in Scotland, which then further reduces the amount of placements that we have available for kids in and from Scotland. It's the criminalisation and stigmatisation of young people in secure care is prevalent. It's not something that we should take great pride in Scotland, is locking up our kids, even if it is in a secure care placement. And that a lot of care experienced young people who were placed in secure care feel as if their voices have been totally shut down. They are told what to do and when to do it, and that is that. There's no conversation around it. And I myself have heard some very tragic experiences of young people who have been in secure care, and it has then furthered the previous trauma they went in there with in the first place, and led to, you know, complete mental health breakdown, complete breakdown in relationships with family and their community, and then trying to, you know, there's no chance of rehabilitation for some of these young people who are now adults and who are now deeper within the criminal justice system. So I do think it's a very complex issue, but I think at the Promise we remain firm in that we shouldn't be locking up our children and young people.
Thanks, Ashley. I probably want to just put on the record that the secure care home in my constituency is excellent, and they have, you know, trauma-informed care. They offer qualifications to young people so they can go on to, you know, positive destinations. I've had many visits with them, and, you know, the experience I've had and I'm hearing that they have is very good. But I think you highlight the problem that there's no sort of uniformity across Scotland with secure care homes, and you know that, you know, great if there are good ones, as there should be for young people, and they offer holistic care, but maybe that's not commonplace and uniformity. You mentioned the, you know, the cross-border issue, and yes, I'm very aware of that, and it's due to the funding mechanism for secure care homes, which again is it seems to be, in my opinion, seems to be inappropriate and inadequate, because again, there's no uniformity. Some secure care homes have to, you know, they all have to bid for money. Some end up getting more money than others. It just doesn't seem to work. So I think we need to look at that as a whole. But certainly the secure care home that I visited and I'm aware of is, you know, is excellent as an alternative. I agree with you, the last resort ever to deprive children of their freedom, but as an alternative to prison and Young Offenders Institutes, I think that, you know, I do think they definitely have a place. Can I maybe bring in Fiona? Sorry, Ashley, yes, come back. Yep.
Just to respond to that as well, I'm not saying that every secure care placement in Scotland is absolutely tragic. Mm-hmm. These are certainly the experiences that I have heard throughout my time campaigning in the care sector. Mm-hmm. And there are good placements there, and currently it is one of the only alternatives to a custodial sentence. Mm-hmm. I think maybe what I didn't make quite clear was the amount of mental health support that is needed to help these children, young people, understand, accept and move on from their trauma is sorely needed. The funding that we currently have for mental health provision, especially for young people, just sadly isn't enough. And I think that if we're going to prevent further criminalisation of the care experience community, then we need to get in their early doors, mm-hmm. To ensure that, you know, they can understand their journey and move on from their trauma.
Yeah, thank you. I agree with that. Fiona, would you like to come in, please?
Yes, thank you. Yes, I totally agree. And we don't want to lock any children up, but unfortunately, some children, to protect themselves and others, do need that form of security. And in Scotland, our secure estate is a better place than the Young Offenders Institution. And there is, as you say, some really good work happening. I think there's been a lot of work recently in the secure care pathway and standards that were co-produced with young people with secure care experience, were introduced earlier this year to try and bring some consistency and improvements around secure care and in the journey into and whilst there and the journey out of secure care to really improve that for the children and young people. And I think, as Ash said, that was listening to children who have been in secure care and really learning from them. But as we've heard, children who have got real complex needs, who have experienced a lot of trauma in their lives, they do need the supports and the secure care need resources. But secure care are care. It is a form of care. It's not a form of punishment. It's care staff, it's social workers, mental health staff who are working in small units within the larger secure environment to really try their best for these children who have just had real trauma and adversity in their life. And that's not going to be something that's a quick fix for these children, but it's definitely a better environment for them than being in a young offenders institution.
Thank you, Fiona. Can I just ask you to comment briefly on the legislative barrier that you mentioned?
Yes. So if you're in court for to be remanded or to have a sentence in secure care, you need to be classed as a child, and therefore you need to be under the age of 16 or 16 and 17 year old on a compulsory supervision through the children's hearing system. Otherwise, the sheriffs are unable to make that placement. They're unable to remand or sentence those young people, even if their needs have been assessed as being better met within secure care. A sheriff or judge has no option but to use a YOI.
Okay, thank you. That's really helpful. That's me, convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm going to just come back to, we've been kind of covering a little bit around custody and secure care, and I'm going to bring in Colette Stevenson. I think you're quite keen to ask a little bit about alternatives to custody.
Yeah, thanks very much, convener. And in terms of, rather than being put into custody, there's two elements to it. And what stood out for me as well, even in the previous session, was about custodial sentences or alternatives and the need to protect, you know, our communities as well. So having spoke to somebody who's gone through the open prison element of it, they'd access to engaging with like Prince's Trust, going out to work, playing football. Is that something that you think that we should have more of? And also as well, we talk about the structured sentencing. How effective is that, and where does social work play a bigger part in that? And one of the things that stood out for me, having worked in outdoor education, is the empirical research around outdoor ed, particularly for youth offending and people who are maybe just going into the criminal justice are at risk. There's quite a lot, I'm throwing quite a lot at you as well. And the other thing that stood out for me, which worked really, really well, and I don't know if any of you can come back on that, is campus cops. So campus cops had in a big school, in one of probably the biggest schools in South Lanarkshire, came in and they were able to actually gauge if there was an element of offending or something coming through and how effective that would be going forward as well. So I know I've thrown a lot at you as well, but I'm keen to hear your thoughts and what evidence is there on that. Thanks.
Do you have a particular witness in mind that you'd like to direct that to?
Perhaps.
Yeah. Niven Rennie, Mr. Rennie, do you want to pick that up?
Yes,
Mr.
Thank
Rennie.
Sorry, convener.
Thank you. I'll pick up some of it, particularly around outdoor activity and campus cops. One of the things that we have regularly encountered is the fact that young people caught up in this system have never had any positive role models in their lives. And the provision of experiences out with the justice setting, you know, in the countryside and sporting events, particularly with campus cops, they're not only getting the experience, but they're getting a positive influence in their life. And that is the whole role of campus cops, in my opinion. Yes, to support the teachers and to be on school when problems arise, but to form positive relationships with the young people. And I don't think we can get enough of that. Young people we've taken recently up to some outdoor activity have never been out with the estate in which they live in their lives. And so there's a need to give people alternatives. And I just want to finally just say before I pass on to other people, the whole thing here is focused on activity after the fact. We need to be focused on prevention. We need to stop people coming into the system. That should be our sole focus. And I couldn't agree more with what Professor Leslie said earlier on about poverty. It's a whole, we tackle each of these issues that we face just now in isolation. We tackle poverty, we need to make a great step forward. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much. I'll bring in Superintendent Convery just on the back of Mr. Rennie's response, if you'd like to pick up.
Thanks, Convener. In relation to primarily about the campus officers, and certainly from our experience of deployment, is they are invaluable for all the benefits that Niven's laid out there. Essentially, they give the positive role models and the alternative route to policing and the support we can give. But I think one of the big benefits that we see from it is about identifying that underlying factor that's leading to a young person becoming identified or being a pattern of behaviour. I think for me, the campus officers are uniquely skilled and placed where they can support teaching staff and all other colleagues across the sectors to help identify what they are and then step in at an early stage to try and get the right intervention before we even get to offending in the first place.
Very much. And Gemma Fraser, I wonder if you'd like to just come in and make a couple of comments on that briefly, if you would.
Yeah, thank you. I completely agree with what Niven highlights about prevention at the earliest stage, but I think from the point of view of the question that was asked, it's important to remember that prevention is about preventing the first offence, but also the 41st offence. I think we need to think about how we use the community, the criminal justice system, I guess, and its set of places, whether that's diversionary, community payback order, custody, as an opportunity to continue that support to helping young people achieve their potential. And as was highlighted in the Sentencing Council, they experience their greatest capacity for change. So it's about how we use all of those elements to think about what we can do better and do differently against what young people need and want to achieve, which is no different to young people outside of that system. And for me, that then means that we ensure that wherever possible, we don't use justice services in the delivery of that support, but that we connect young people to universal services within their communities through existing community planning networks and landscapes that ensure that young people have a trajectory that doesn't otherise them or continue otherisation and justice, but places them firmly in a community that welcomes them back and integrates them and supports rehabilitation on a different level, I think.
Very much. This is obviously a topical discussion. I know Diane Dobie, you'd quite like to come in, and I'll just finish off this particular discussion with Professor McCara. So, Diane Dobie, do you want to come in?
Yeah, thank you. I'll try and be a bit more concise in my response this time. Yes, I wanted to comment a bit on the structured deferred sentencing and just elaborate a little bit on that. So, in the Lanarkshire, actually there was a pilot that was undertaken and was evaluated by the University of West of Scotland and also by Community Justice Scotland. It was introduced as a kind of partnership approach to try and reduce further the criminalisation of young people who were under the age of 21. It was applied to young people who had complex needs, and it was a partnership approach between the court and Action for Children, Action for Industry. So some of our colleagues in housing services as well. And basically it involved doing a sort of expedited assessment, getting the young person's support, really following their journey from leaving court. So, for example, just ensuring like the links to poverty and connecting young people with like a bus pass, ensuring that they were registered with a GP, ensuring that they managed to get some stable housing. At other times, it involved supporting them with their relationships with with family, and when they had to appear in court, supporting them to do that. So at the end of that, there was the majority of young people, it was over 80%, ended up being admonished at the end of their order. Now, as much as that's really great, ultimately we don't want them in the justice system at all, but there were really positive outcomes in terms of the structured deferred sentence. And I think the bit that worked there was a bit about the relationship and the time to do that relationship. It was pretty intensive. It required a lot of resource, but it was a particularly good return on investment for those young people. And in terms of one of the other measures linked to the question was in relation to sort of other supports. So a lot of them were involved, and they moved along the sort of employability pipeline. So they were more ready for work. Some of them ended up in college placements, etc. So overall, really positive. In that one study, so I just wanted to reflect that was a really positive alternative to custody, which was kind of tailored to meet the needs of young people.
Thank you very much for that. I'm just conscious of time, so I'm going to just come back to focus briefly, if we may, on secure care. I know, Pauline McNeill, you had a question on that, if you'd like to pick up, and then I'll move on to community sentencing and bring Jamie Green in.
Thanks. I'll make it quick. To be honest, I'm not sure who'd be best placed to answer it, so you can help me. So we've heard a lot of really important stuff about, from Ashley, for example, about secure care itself, probably needs reviews and all of that, but I really just want to highlight the case. I'm sure there are others, of William Lindsay Brown. I know we're going to discuss deaths in custody, but my question is, the sheriff was, everyone was quite clear in that case. This is a 16-year-old who should have been referred to secure care and not a prison, but it wasn't available. That's my understanding. So my question is, has anything happened since that case? I know there are other cases to deal with what seems to be a lack of secure care, and we are also, I believe, only mandated to a maximum of 70% or 80%, leaving the remainder for English placements. I do not understand, if anyone could could help me understand why we've done this, and has anyone get any answers as to whether or not we have actually acted since that? Because to me, it's a death that could have possibly been avoided.
I wonder, maybe Ms. Dyer, would you be able to come in on that perhaps?
Yeah, I agree. That was really tragic in relation to William, and I do believe it was through a lack of beds. And I think it was your colleague referred to earlier, it's in relation to funding in secure care, because they are a charity and they need to generate their own income in relation to the number of young people that they have there. I do believe there are emergency beds in all the units as well, but there are currently 50% of our secure care beds have young people who out from out with Scotland as of yesterday, I believe that was the figure, and that is just due to the funding. And I suppose in one advantage it's because we don't need a lot of beds in Scotland, and we are managing a lot of young people in the communities and in different ways. But I think that was just tragic and it shouldn't happen. But I think until we look at the funding model and look at always having beds available, and that, unfortunately, there has been discussions, but that is still progressing as speaking, and I'm sure it'll take time. It'll take time, and that doesn't mean that what happened to William won't happen again.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. And just while we're on, Ms. McNeill, you touched on the issue of deaths in custody. I wonder if I can maybe just ask a follow-up question, perhaps directed to Hannah Graham, just around whether or not you've got any concerns about deaths in custody and perhaps deaths following custody. So, for example, delays in FAIs, lack of findings of concern to or support following release. So just wondering if there's anything you'd like to pick up on around that.
Thank you, Convener. So my written evidence submission and those of my colleagues at the University of Glasgow for the earlier roundtable on prisons both cover deaths on community sentences in my case and deaths in custody and following release in the case of my University of Glasgow colleagues. And the very reason that we have highlighted that analysis and in some cases perhaps figures newly in the public domain that have not been highlighted in that way before is because we are very concerned. We can speak for years, we can have commissions for years, we can have reviews for years about the problems of imprisonment or the use of custody. And in those years, or we can speak about wanting alternatives to custody and community sentences. Our analysis in those written evidence submission shows some quite serious considerations. And so in the community sentences on one type over a 7-year period, you've got 1,178 people who died whilst community payback orders that were listed as finished because of a death. And we have the submission from my colleagues about quite substantive concerns around deaths in custody. Both of these submissions, what they have in common is we're concerned particularly about suicide and we're concerned about drug-related deaths, as well as all other deaths. And in raising such a sensitive topic, it is done with the compassion and the dignity it deserves, but also the passion and the fire that it deserves. We need to pay attention. The Chief Inspector of Prisons has recommended in her written evidence that there needs to be a review into deaths in custody and following post-release. So that could include parole and non-parole licences and other types of licences. The figures that I've presented are around, they could be summarised probably in 4 or 5 words. So for the people that are dying on community payback orders, they're young, they're mostly unemployed, they're criminalised and they are dead. And if this does not spark an interest that criminologists, human rights advocates, healthcare workers and social workers have been trying to draw attention to what happens when earlier needs are not met, like mental health care, substance use, physical health care, and when earlier inequalities and disparities are not addressed, we have unfortunately some substantive concerns around what happens, and that includes the deaths of young people in custody, as well as the deaths of young people on community payback orders. So in 2019 to 2020, amongst the deaths for that year on community payback orders, 61.3% were aged between 16 and 40 years old. So what we know is that this is not an age that we would typically expect to be dying. And there are bereaved families. The media will pay attention to the deaths in custody, and that is wholly understandable given the gravity of what's happened and the duty of the state. They have access potentially to fatal accident inquiries afterwards if the Lord Advocate and COPFS decide. People on community sentences who are dying, we have far less data. We have under-reporting of it as a serious incident to the Care Inspectorate, and we have quite worrying concerns, not only for community payback orders, but 8 or 9 types of orders or licences in the community. This is an area that has not had as much attention given to it or as much understanding given to it as it could be, but it is the resources and the relationships needed much earlier in the system and in the process so that we can learn, because it's very hard to be held accountable if you do not count the deaths on community sentences. And then the Scottish Prison Service do have a statutory duty to report data on their website on the deaths in prison custody, and that's what my colleagues at the University of Glasgow have provided an analysis of, and they'll have more releases to come on that in the weeks to come. But yeah, it's under-reporting is a big issue, and we have the care inspectorate saying that all of the deaths they've been notified of, which is a fraction of the actual deaths on community orders and licences, which is concerning because of the criteria, that the majority they think are drug deaths or suicide related.
Ms Graham, thank you for that. I very much appreciate your passion and your insight. I'm just going to move things on just because of pressure of time, but thank you. Can I bring in Jamie Green now, and we'll maybe move on to looking at community sentencing. Thank you.
Thank you, and can I put on the record my thanks to the academics who've put in some great work on the death in custody issue, which has been so rightly highlighted in today's media, and it raises important issues. Dr. Graham's done excellent work on this, on an area that was previously perhaps unreported, and the University of Glasgow on FAIs. It is worrying, I think, that 9 in 10 of FAIs that were analysed by those academics were found to have produced no recommendations at all on things that can change. And one well-quoted mother of a young girl who sadly died in a young offenders institution said that the FAI system is broken. And that's something we've heard time and time again in this country. But that's maybe an observation rather than a question in the interest of time. I thought maybe instead of talking about community sentencing, which we could spend all day on, if I could ask a different question. And that's about prevention. And the reason I ask that is that I think there's perhaps this perception that Scotland doesn't suffer from the same levels of young gang violence that perhaps other cities do in other parts of either the UK or in the world. But we do know that serious organised crime is an issue, because we know that through the numbers of inmates who are involved in serious organised crime. Can I ask what work do you think is being done or not being done to ensure that young people are not being sucked into serious organised crime at a young age, so that we can prevent them falling into that trap of ending up in prison as high tariff, high profile offenders? To whom?
Would you like to direct that to
anyone that's to anyone that's interested? Perhaps crime prevention is the main thrust of this.
Mr. Rennie, can I suggest, Mr. Rennie, would you like to come in on that?
Yes, thank you very much. I actually, by dint of my post as Director of Scottish Violence Reduction Unit, I'm actually chairing a body right across the UK involving the 17 Violence Reduction Units and a number of other organisations called the Hope Collective. And it has that very aim that Mr. Green has asked about, because to me, the one issue that you need to provide to stop people getting involved in serious organised crime or criminality is to give them hope and aspiration and opportunity. People need to have alternatives, and it doesn't matter whether you're in London, Liverpool, Manchester, Glasgow or Aberdeen. It goes back to some of the other issues we touched on throughout this session this morning. When people have been brought up in poverty, they have a lack of opportunity, and as Harry Burns, the former chief medical officer, calls it, a sense of hopelessness. And if we leave people with that lack of choices, then somebody else will fill it. And the people who tend to fill it are people offering a quick buck, or an opportunity to wear Gucci trainers, or to drive in a fast car. And that tends to be serious and organised crime. So the answer to our problems keep coming back to this one issue, tackling the inequality in our towns and cities.
Thank you. That's a brief answer. And finally, we also know from looking at the current backlog of court cases that around 80% or perhaps more of those are related to sexual crimes or indeed crimes of violence against women and children. I suspect the average age of those accused is higher than perhaps other types of crime. However, we do know that these types of crimes can often extend from adverse behaviour and experiences at younger ages. What has been done similar to addressing the prevention of violent crime to prevent people who will go on to commit sexual crime? Perhaps Mr. Rennie might want to follow on that.
Well, there's a lot of work ongoing. We have projects ongoing just now to look, working with young people, looking at harmful sexual behaviour in schools. Young people does a Mentors and Violence Prevention Programme now delivered by Education Scotland does that sort of work as well. That's not to say there isn't an awful lot more that could be done, and perhaps the academics might be better placed to answer that.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I wonder if I'll just bring in Superintendent Convery, if you would like to say a few words on that.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. It was more in response to Mr. Green's first question around about how we're supporting young people who are exposed or become involved in serious organised crime. Of course, the SOC strategy that we've got in consultation with government and national effort focuses on that, and very much focuses on the divert aspect and trying to divert young people away from that opportunity. We also recognise, though, that there will always be individuals who end up caught up in it and may end up incarcerated. There's a big effort we put in just now with our colleagues at SPS, the Police Officer Deployment Department, to work with the young men to understand and try and create positive opportunities and positive lifestyle choices for them. And that obviously then feeds into the work that Niven and his team do at Violence Reduction Unit. So I think it's about diversion, but it's also about fundamental understanding what the problem is. But I think it comes out, again, comes back to provision of service to others to support these young people and give them that hope and aspiration that they can achieve.
Thank you very much indeed. Fiona Dyer, would you like to come in on this just before we move on?
Yes, I think just to say as well, I think especially since COVID, but there is an issue with child criminal exploitation as well as child sexual exploitation. And these are children who are victims, and they're being victimised mainly by adults and be getting brought into criminalised behaviour or getting brought into sexualised behaviour. Now, a lot is online, but also there's a lot more since during the pandemic online, but now we're more back face-to-face. There's evidence that, you know, it's back on the ground again. And I think that's just something to bear in mind, that these children are actually victims first, and that they need to be treated as victims. So there's work going on in relation to that, but probably not enough in Scotland that we're really recognising these children as victims first instead of criminalising them. And there is some young people currently in Pullman from a Vietnamese background who we believe have been trafficked, and they are victims as well, but we are locking them up for their potentially for their own protection as well as because they have been actually criminalised themselves. And I think that's something in Scotland that we need to get better.
Thank you very much. I'm just conscious of the time, so if there are no more questions from members, then I would intend just pulling this session to a close. If any of the witnesses, if you feel that there is anything outstanding that you would like to share with the committee, please feel free to do so in writing, and the committee will of course take that evidence into account. So my grateful thanks to all our witnesses today. I'm sure we could have continued the discussion for a lot longer, but thank you again for your participation today. And I'll just bring this part of the meeting to a close before, and have a short break before we move into a private session. Thank you.